Do you hear me, Doug?
Yeah, I can hear you.
I can use that up a little. Yeah. 1, 2, 3. I could use that. I need more volume there.
investment. Another right hand to the body. Gonna bring it back. Oh, yes. Down goes Hernandez. A right blistering right hand over the top by Brewer.
Thompson Boxing, we're here for you. It's been 609 days since we were here at the Doubletree Hotel, the home away from home for Thompson Boxing. I'm Beth Duran, joined alongside California Boxing Hall of Famer Rich Morata and the newest inductee into the West Coast Boxing Hall of Fame, Doug Fisher. Doug, congratulations to you. And we are here with you, the fans, and we enjoy it. So during the pandemic, we've been inside a warehouse. Corona, we're slowly getting the fans back, right. And we're here with you, and you can feel the energy inside the Doubletree. And Rich, let me just start with you.
Yeah.
When you think about boxing and what we had to go through during the pandemic and COVID and the restrictions of what's going on, the club shows really took a toll.
Yes.
But Thompson's Box has been able to keep going some way, somehow. I don't know how, but they've been able to do it. Mr. Ken Thompson, Alex Campanovo. But club boxing is really the backbone for the sport, isn't it?
Right, of course. It's the lifeblood. And you said the number. 609 days. Think of that. That's a staggering number. So it was a real hit for club boxing in the Southern California area. And club boxing has been the lifeblood, really, and the developing stream for boxing and championships and champions in the Southern California area for decades, really. It's nothing new. So when you go 609 days without your boxing community being able to gather in a room like this, because this is a room where careers are developed. This is a room where champions are developed. And this is the boxing community coming back together. And I'll tell you, when they went out to Omega Products and they had the outdoor show 2 months ago where they were able to resume boxing once again with fans in attendance, it meant so much to the fighters. They were motivated by it, and it meant so much to the fans to be able to attend again as well.
Yeah, and it's one thing to have it, Rich, where people are able to yell at you while they're having a beer and a hot dog. You gotta love that,
that's
right?
It, man.
It's like the club fans will let you know, boo or no boo,
that's
what's going on. And Doug Fisher, when you look at the club fighters, I love talking to both of you guys because it's, remember when this guy started here before he went to the pay-per-view, before he went to the titles, I mean, whatever it is. Heck, you've seen a lot of guys in this hotel room.
Timothy Bradley, 2006.
Perfect example. And the guy we're going to see in the main event tonight, Miguel Madueño, who was plucked out of a farm in Wasabi, Sinaloa, and he shows up here. We have no idea who he is, fighting like a caveman. And then we've seen all his pro fights. This guy is starting to make some noise, and he's our main event tonight.
Yeah, we saw him. We were the first to see him in the U.S., but we only got a glimpse.
Yeah.
It was a first-round knockout, and it let us know that he had potential to be an exciting fighter. We didn't know how far he could go, how high his ceiling was, because it was just one round against subpar opposition. But what we saw, we liked. Physically strong, very aggressive. Obviously, there's punching power there. We saw him the second time here in the United States, this time outside the Omega Products International Event Center. Another first-round knockout. He looked a little bit more polished, but still, I mean, what do we have? Like a minute and a half to go on. Now, his last fight, I believe it was in Florida against Sonny Fredrickson.
That fight
went 10 rounds. It was a hard fight. It was an entertaining fight, really, like almost a fight of the year candidate, where he proved himself to be more than just punching power. He showed us stamina. He showed us a sturdy chin. And he proved that he's not a front runner. A lot of pure punchers, they get discouraged if they can't knock a guy out in three or four rounds. And he broke this guy down in the late rounds when the guy was fighting back and got a 10th round stoppage. So we know that he's real. And tonight, I think it's like just continuing that progression by putting him in with a tough Mexican opponent, fellow Mexican opponent, who's going to give him rounds because his opponent tonight doesn't get knocked out.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter how tough he's in, he goes rounds. I think he's been stopped like maybe once, Mario Barrios, in the seventh round. So we're going to get some quality rounds here, and that's what's going to develop Madueño. And, you know, from here on, maybe he's a prospect at 140 pounds. He weighed in at 136. Maybe he's a prospect at lightweight.
And that'll be our main event tonight. So for those of you guys who are looking for Anthony Chavez, he is off of the card. He had an abscess tooth. He went to the ER this morning, and he is off the card. I know he has a lot of friends and family that were coming tonight. And also, those of you wondering, with Manny, Gucci Manny, who Joel Diaz trains, he is also not on the card. So we have four fights coming your way. There are good ones. You'll also see Lázaro Vargas, Eros Correa, and Esteban Munoz. So that'll be four fights coming your way. And we know we interact with you. So if you have questions for the Hall of Famers, we're going to be with you. A couple years ago, we started this, and Rich Morano's first broadcast, he went from doing TV to going, wait a minute, we're actually talking to the crowd. It's different, Rich, right?
I know.
It's fun.
I hadn't seen anything like that. I was a little scared about it, but I'm kind of getting used to it now.
Yeah, exactly. We interact with you, YouTube, Facebook, and now we see everything you say. There's an app for it. Thompson Boxing continues to evolve in the club shows world, and we give you what you have, give you access, and there's an app. Go down and download it, the Thompson Boxing app. And for more on that, here's the fourth member of our crew, the one and only Jessica Rosales.
All right, you guys, now, as if we haven't made it easy enough for you guys to access some free boxing, we said, why not give everybody a free boxing app as well? We do have the Thompson Boxing app. It is available right now in the App Store. So if you're not watching us on your phone, get that phone out right now. Search Thompson Boxing. You will see the app right there on the home screen. It gives you the option to watch the fights live. So if you're out at work or wherever it is, you can always watch the fights there, right there in your pocket. Don't worry, we're not going to tell your boss, I promise. But you can also get all of the latest information on what's going on with fighters, what's going on with them in camp, as well as some behind the scenes footage, a lot of really cool highlight reels. And the best part about it is that you do get some fighter bios on there as well. This is the best way to stay up to date with all the latest going on with Thompson Boxing. Now, as I mentioned, that app is available right now. It is free. Just go to the app store that you have on your phone and search Thompson Boxing. It will pop right up. So make sure you guys are checking out that app. And of course, tonight, talk with us on social media, use that hashtag Thompson Boxing. We're going to keep an eye on your guys' comments as well. See what you're saying. Let us know what you think about that app, okay? So let's talk about tonight's events. We're going to talk about the co-main event. This is going to be a very fun one. We've got two undefeated fighters, so you know that it is going to go down. We have Eros Correa with a record of 10-0 and Katsuma Akitsugi boasting a record of 6-0. Now, Correa is saying that his strength is going to be what stands out tonight. Seven of his wins have come by way of knockout in comparison to just one win by knockout for Akitsugi. Correa also told us that look out for this fight because it might possibly be the fight of the night. Now, Akitsugi saying to us that his camp is kind of like the building block. Each time that he's in camp, he builds up to the next level, and he's feeling confident that tonight he has built the proper foundation to get him the win against what he is saying is probably one of his toughest opponents. Now, moving on to the main event, we've got the lightweight division, and it is scheduled to go 8 rounds. We've got Miguel Angel Madueño against Jose Luis Rodriguez, two Guerreros Mexicanos that will be going at it in the main event. Now, Rodriguez telling us that, you know, he likes to take his opponents the distance. He's hoping to stop that knockout record that Madueño has going on, that streak that he's been having. Now, Madueño telling us that he's trying to keep that momentum from his last fight going. He's stayed in the gym, but more importantly, yes, he is known for his power. He's known for knocking guys out, but he's been working on his skill set, and he's hoping to surprise his opponent tonight. So that is going to be in the main event, as we said, scheduled to go 8 rounds. Now tonight, we're getting ready to get things started here at the Doubletree in Ontario. We're happy to be back, and of course, we're happy to show you the first fight of the night. It is scheduled for 4 rounds. We have Lázaro Vargas against Ulises Rosales. No relation as far as I know, but let's go ahead and take a look back at yesterday's weigh-in.
All right, fans, let's get the party started. Please welcome onto the red corner from Baja California, Tijuana, Mexico. Here is Ulises Rosales.
Coming in.
Here we go, here we go. Coming in from... This is Ulises Rosales. One, two.
Well, hopefully Ulises knows the way to the ring here.
One, two, there we go. Rich Murata, Doug Fisher. Rich, where's this guy? He's supposed to be at the, walking in.
Maybe he stopped off at one of the lovely restaurants here at the
Doubletree. Well, we did have a good lunch here at the Doubletree today. The wings are jamming, but he already made the way in. But it's Ulises Rosales from Tijuana, Mexico, is where he trains. But he's from Guadalajara, Jalisco, Mexico.
And we are all looking for him.
There he is.
There he is.
All right, so here we, Ulises Rosales, he's 0-4, but he's a tough kid. He comes in, I went back there and talked to him real quick, Doug. I was like, oh, you're from Tijuana, right? He's like, nah, that's what they put down. I'm Jalisco, I'm Guadalajara. So can you fix that? I'm like, I got you, bro, I'll fix that. Club boxing, baby, we take care of everybody. Sonny Franco, one more.
And now please welcome his opponent, making his way to the ring out of the blue corner from Coachella, California, Lazaro Rodriguez.
Lazaro Vargas, Coachella, California. Carlos Gracias, his trainer, also has Joel Diaz in his corner, so he's 3-0. And I'm not going to get into the business of predicting it, but don't blink in this fight. This dude comes to swing, comes to throw. 21 years old.
You ask him what his best attribute is as a fighter, and he looks right at you and says power.
Yeah. Okay.
Puncher's mentality.
Doug Fisher.
How do I sound?
A little bit more, Doug. All right, Sonny Franco. Go for it, Sonny. Go for it.
And welcome, fight fans joining us from coast to coast on ThompsonBoxing.com. We're coming to you live from the Doubletree Hotel in Ontario, California. For tonight, Thompson Boxing Promotions is proud to present The Path to Glory. We begin tonight's event with the first bout of the evening, scheduled for four rounds of action in the Super Bantamweight Division. At ringside, your three judges scoring the bout should it go the distance are Fernando Villarreal, Max DeLuca, and Eddie Hernandez. And the man in charge of the action at the bell, your referee, Rudy Barragan. Here we go, fight fans. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner. He steps in the ring tonight wearing the purple trunks with black. When he stepped onto the scale, he weighed in officially at 119.4 ready pounds. As a professional, his record stands 0 victories against 4 defeats. Ladies and gentlemen, damas y caballeros, de Baja California, Tijuana, Mexico, introducing Ulises Rosales. And introducing his opponent, fighting across the ring out of the blue corner. He stepped to the ring tonight wearing the black trunks trimmed with white. When he stepped onto the scale, he weighed in at 121.5 solid pounds. Tonight, he enters the ring undefeated. 3 victories with no defeats. 2 of his victories coming to you by way of KO. Ladies and gentlemen, from Coachella, California, here is Lazaro Vargas. Once again, your referee in charge, Rudy Barragan, to get the final instructions.
Carlos, come on and center. Las instrucciones, ¿ok? Cuídense a todos tiempos. Escúchenme a todos tiempos, ¿ok? Buena suerte. Los dos.
Rudy Barragan, the third man in the ring, Rich Murata.
Despite that gigantic difference in height that you saw, 5'6 to 5'2, there's only a 2 pounds difference in their weight, but there certainly is a massive difference in their record. So it'll be up to Ulysses to see if he can prove something. He's still trying.
609 days since we were here at the Doubletree in Ontario. Good to be back home. This was scheduled for four rounds. Dr. Duran, Rich Murata, and Doug Fisher. And there's the power right away from Lázaro Vargas. He's jumping in, digging to the body in black and white. You can hear the thuds of the punches immediately. Lázaro is not wasting any kind of time at all as the fighter from Guadalajara gets the ropes. Finally, Rosales gets off of the ropes. Vicious intentions, Doug, from Lázaro Vargas.
It's smart of Vargas to aim to the body. This guy is a southpaw. He can be crafty in there. You want to immobilize him, take away his legs, get him up against the ropes, and execute him.
Vargas.
I like that Rosales has fought back here a little bit.
Yep. He's 0-4, but it's a tough 0-4. He goes in there and trades with you, the couple fights that I saw. And he's eating some punches upstairs.
Vargas, as you can see, is a very much an unfinished product. And he believes in his power. And as Doug pointed out, he's using body punches. Guys that knock out a lot of guys early in their career.
Good left hook from Vargas early on. The face of the young Mexican Rosales is already red here through the first round.
I think Rosales has got cobwebs in his head right now. Yeah. He's definitely feeling those body shots. Credit to him for staying upright.
In the corner again. This one's only scheduled for four rounds. Rudy Barragan, veteran referee, keeping a close eye on. Won't let a young fighter take too much punishment. Vargas. Lázaro Vargas started boxing at the age of 14. His dad actually trained with Lee Espinoza in Coachella. He started with Lee Espinoza in Coachella, now trained with Joel and Carlos Gracia in Indio. And his main sparring partner, the 122-pound champion, Doug. MJ, they call it.
Oh, yeah. Akhmadaliev.
Yep, that's who he spars with, him and Brandon Figueroa.
Oh my goodness.
You know, we talked about club fighting earlier, and you mentioned Lee Espinoza. That guy was at every club fight everywhere, it seemed like, around Southern California.
Yes, a fixture of Southern California boxing. And he was inducted into the West Coast Boxing Hall of Fame this past Sunday.
Oh, that's awesome. And congratulations, Doug, to you. We'll talk about that later on. The newest inductee of the West Coast Boxing Hall of Fame. Oh, good left hook from Vargas.
Well, if Vargas views himself as a puncher, I have to imagine Rosales might be etching into his head a little bit, creating some doubts in that punching power.
Well, now Vargas has settled down a little bit from that frantic start of his.
Yeah. Final seconds of the opening round. I didn't expect to go to the second. But credit to Rosales.
Didn't look like it.
Through the first, and we go to the second.
Didn't look like it at the sound of the bell.
Transforming spaces into beautiful places. Thompson Building Materials, Orange, Fontana, Camarillo, San Diego, Ripon, Sacramento. ThompsonsBLDG.com for more information. And you see the Thompson Building Materials trucks all over Southern California. You can't get on the freeway and not see one of Mr. Thompson's trucks. And then you see Joel Diaz in the corner, Rich. He has a brand new gym that he built himself, he along with Tonio, in Indio, California. It used to be a furniture store. He bought the building years ago, converted into a gym now that he's running himself.
I'm glad to see that. You know, I'm glad to see that there's people investing in the future of boxing.
It's good for the youth of that area, of the Coachella, Indio area. It's a place for them to come and work out, whether or not they want to actually compete in boxing. And those who have that talent and that desire, it's going to be cultivated there.
It also has morning workouts for the community.
Yeah.
You're starting to see the boxercise. And if you've ever done a boxing workout, you know it's not hard. It's not easy. Three rounds hitting the bag, forget it.
Yeah, It looks like Vargas is going to do a little bit of boxing in this second round.
Which is good. A young fighter needs to box.
Yeah, he threw everything at Rosales in the opening 3 minutes. Rosales survived. And it could be that Vargas is, you know, that heart's pumping. He's, you know, doesn't want to punch himself out. So he's going to be a little more choosy with his punch selection, which is a smart thing.
And Vargas is in an on-the-job training kind of situation. Now, he only had 24 amateur fights, so, you know, 18-6, so, you know, which is not dazzling. So he is learning as he goes and develops along the way as well.
Yeah, I was talking to his dad, like, what was the deal behind that? And Coach Gracia said, we decided, he started boxing at the age of 14 seriously. In high school is when he really took boxing seriously. He was playing soccer. He was doing a bunch of other sports. They said, once he got serious, it was better for us to just train instead of going to a tournament every weekend. And all of a sudden, it's like, oh, you win this tournament. For what? Better to get quality work. And then the tournaments that they would go to were the Desert Showdown.
Sure.
The big showcases.
Right.
Where you're going up against guys with 100 amateurs.
Well, if your goal is to turn pro, and you don't have dreams of being a U.S. national champ or an Olympian or something like that, it's better to get gym work against professional fighters to learn the professional style.
And settling down, Rich, is what you want to see from a young fighter, right? Especially at the age of 21.
Yeah, because they got to realize that not everybody's going to fall down as soon as you lay those pillows on him.
Really?
And it's better to realize that against somebody that is no offensive threat at all. And that's what Vargas is learning. And now, you know what he gets to practice? Now that Rosales is utilizing a little bit of lateral movement, Vargas gets to practice cutting the ring off.
It's just something that you can have, but then you just, until you get in the ring, right, Rich, it's just, you just don't know.
Exactly, and he can do something. Now we're starting to see that he can do some things, you know, in there. Now, if he'd have blown out Rosales in 30 seconds, we wouldn't know it. He might not know it.
Yeah, all we would know is that he could punch. We wouldn't get a good look at his boxing foundation or his punching technique or his defensive prowess, if any.
Final seconds of the second round. Good one. Good young fighters going at it. And opening bout on Thompson Boxing. All right, what are you guys saying on the Facebook? And there it is, the Thompson Boxing app. Android, iPhone, whatever you do, you'll see whatever you want.
And I want you to know, if you're an older fight fan, I am not tech savvy, and I am an older boxing announcer, but I got that
wait
app, and it's easy to operate.
Very simple.
You got the app on the flip phone?
There it is, baby.
Oh, you have an iPhone? Rich Barada has an
there
iPhone.
It is.
That is fantastic. Of course, Rich, longtime boxing broadcaster, has seen it, the Forum Boxing Days. The showbox days, everything else, and I just love working with you. A longtime host of the boxing show on Saturdays on KLAC.
The Neutral Corner.
The Neutral
right?
Corner.
Yeah.
I used to listen to it.
That was Rich Murata's Neutral Corner. There is now a Neutral Corner podcast.
Right, that's from Michael Montero.
Michael Montero has that, one of our colleagues. I think, ironically, that I'm the only guy now who does not have a podcast.
Why don't you? Why don't you, Rich? Give me boxing stories. That's what I love to hear. Well, you got plenty of time when you're gambling in Nevada. Let's go.
You don't want to hear those stories.
Good action picking up here to start the third. Lázaro Vargas in the black and white, old school Mike Tyson look. Upstairs, but Vargas is realizing that Rosales, his opponent in the purple, can take a punch.
You know, it's interesting when he gets Rosales in that corner there, he still uses the jab on him. He still stays at long range and uses the jab, even though he's got him pinioned there in the corner.
Rosales is that typical tough Mexican fighter who shows up with one guy who's his trainer, cut man, manager. It just comes to brawl with you. Guys that are the backbone of the sport.
Go forward!
Vargas is not backing away from that body, though. Whether he's in close or on the outside, and I think that's where he needs to be, given Rosales' height and reach. Behooves Vargas to just throw straight shots to the body, and he showed a nice straight right to the midsection. He just needs to follow that up with a hook or go right back to the jab. But he can break Rosales down to the body without getting chest to chest.
Credit to Rosales. That was some good work right there defensively. He's moving his head and a little side-to-side movement there. And he looked like he was going to get blown out in the first 45 seconds of this fight. And he hung in there. And I think Doug was right when he said he had some cobwebs early. But, you know, those cobwebs cleared, and he's coming back.
Look at this. That's the best flurry of the night for a young fighter from Guadalajara. Less than a minute to go in the third round. Scheduled for four, and you start to hear the crowd oohing and on. It's so good to hear the crowd back in here at the Doubletree in Ontario.
It's great to see them get behind the underdog. And just to recognize his courage and the fact that, you know, he could have looked for that soft spot in the canvas and just called it a night, said check please, but
yep,
he's sticking his nose in there. He's giving us an effort.
In the corner is Vargas working Rosales.
I love that straight right to the body from Vargas. He needs to tuck his chin a little bit better when he does it. But all he needs to do, throw that straight right to the body, come up with the hook, back out with the jab.
Third round winding down. A good one, our opening bout here on Thompson Boxing, the Doubletree Hotel in Ontario. Up next, Esteban Munoz, Manuel Martinez, Stonehands. He's trained by Henry Ramirez here in Riverside County. Manuel Martinez, you talk about a dude who's just like, yeah, give me gloves, I'll fight you. That's him.
These guys have attitude in that fight coming up.
I try to talk to him, he's like, yeah,
I tell you though, if you want to call yourself Stonehands, you got something to live up to.
Yeah, he acknowledges that, too. He didn't like that nickname at first. He's like, hey, I don't want to be compared to Hands of Stone.
No, really. I mean, you want to call yourself Stone
but
Hands?
But it's catchy, and everybody calls him that at the gym, and people like saying it. When I first heard it, I thought they were saying Stonehenge, like in English. Like, I don't know. Like, he had some dreams of being, like, a knight or something like that. Folks say it real fast, Stonehands. Did I say Stonehenge?
All right, fourth and final round. Randall Flagg on YouTube. He deserves some credit for being so tough. I agree with you, man. Rosales is the purple, the southpaw. Definitely is tough. Saludos a toda la gente que lo está mirando en español, pero perdón, esta pelea lo estamos transmitiendo en inglés. So I'll mix it into Spanish, but not too much, bro. They don't pay me for bilingual.
Rosales is warmed up now.
Yeah, he is.
His technique is a lot tighter here in the fourth round than it was in the opening round.
Rosales wishes this was a six-rounder.
Yeah. I think it would be an advantage for him.
Yeah, Rosales 0-4. He's been stopped twice, but he's 28 years old. He comes to give you, Steve Kim would say, that professional resistance. And Lázaro Vargas tonight in the white gloves is learning some things about himself, which is good.
Yeah, it's really better for him, actually. A clash of heads.
Yeah, the clock is going to stop there. Ah, that's not too bad.
Is he cut? I can't tell.
He's holding that right eye really.
Let's see.
Rudy Balagan is there.
No blood.
Said it wasn't on purpose.
But hey, when bone clashes bone and you get somebody's forehead in your eye socket, that's nasty.
Rudy Balagan.
It's really bothering him. He's...
Yeah, he's looking into his trainer. Yeah, referee Rudy Balagan say, talk to me, don't talk to your corner. Like, don't stop it, but you're not getting instruction here. That's a little savvy move though, right? Try to get some instruction. And he's also buying some time here. Good
he is, he's getting a lot of time.
What up, Nick Martin? Hell no, I ain't getting no bilingual pay, bro. Pay me in English and you hear the crowd getting after it. Feels good to be back here at the Doubletree. We got three more fights after this, and if you're on YouTube or Facebook, make sure you share it.
this is a ruthless suggestion, but if Vargas is being savvy, he starts dropping some jabs and some hooks on that tender eye.
As you should, right?
Sure. I mean, it's all's fair in love and war.
Nothing there. They stepped on each other's feet.
Yep.
I like the way Vargas digs to the body. Only 21 years old.
He's definitely committed to the body attack.
You know, I have no rooting interest in this fight whatsoever, but I'm kind of hoping Rosales, oh, he's going down. I'm just going to say I hope he can last the distance.
That was a little low. A little low. We can call the time.
Must have been a low blow.
Yeah, I was locked out. Didn't see it from here, but Rudy's going to give him the time. That was a low blow, Balagan is telling him. So now it's 5 minutes, is that right?
Yes. Rosales has up to 5 minutes.
Yes, but this...
I've never seen a fighter take the full five.
This fourth round could take 10 minutes.
It was feeling like that.
Now, tonight's fight, Rich, what did they weigh in at? What? 121?
121 for Vargas and 119 and a half for Rosales.
So Vargas, it was one of those, let's just get a fight. His original opponent didn't come through. He should be fighting at 118. That's where his future is at for Vargas.
Wow. Vargas can make bantamweight.
Yep.
He has a frame of a big junior featherweight or featherweight, whereas Rosales looks like he could fight at flyweight or junior bantamweight.
Yeah, talking with Coach Gracia, he said 118 is where he will be right now.
Yeah.
But
he's 22. He can make it.
Exactly.
He can sweat down.
So then he'll go to 22, but right now it's 18 is where he belongs. Good scrap. Good scrap.
It's good for Vargas because it's made him think. I can tell he's thinking in here. He's like, well, what combination is going to work on this guy? What's going to break him down? How am I going to land the sure shot? He's also thinking about, do I have the engine? Yeah. You know, do I need to lessen my punch output?
Well, I don't think he's got too discouraged, but I think he has adjusted here.
Yes, he has. But you got to think to make those adjustments, and that's what he's doing.
And that'll do it. They go four rounds. You know what? Shout out to our man from Guadalajara, Rosales, who puts his hands up. He lost every round, but he won the crowd, and he won me because I was impressed. I thought he was going to get blown out.
Same here.
And I didn't expect that. I didn't do many notes on him. And when I went back there, I kid you not, Rich, 20 minutes before they walked, he was still getting wrapped. So it wasn't like there was any kind of urgency in that corner. But he's tough, man. I mean, he's going to fall 0-5, but hey, we'll come back with the results, the official results from Sonny Franco and you. Keep on leaving the comments on Facebook and YouTube on Thompson Boxing.
Experience the world's largest compatible cordless system. Makita's LXT batteries take you from power tools to outdoor power equipment. The blower delivers power comparable to a 24cc gas model. From the job site to your home, reach speeds of 116 miles per hour. Use Makita's cordless products anytime, anywhere. One system, endless possibilities. Now get two extra free batteries.
Paving the way to your personal sanctuary that you simply can't stop thinking about. Find yours at Belgar.com.
Ladies and gentlemen, after four exciting rounds of boxing action, to the judges' scorecards we go. All three judges, Fernando Villarreal, Max DeLuca, and Eddie Hernandez, all seat about the same. 40-36, declaring your winner by unanimous decision, and still undefeated from Coachella, California, Lazaro.
He had to work for it, but Lázaro Vargas gets the victory. Four good rounds for the young man from Coachella, California. Gracias Boxing, Joel Diaz Training Camp. Rich, what did you like about this young man tonight?
Well, I like the fact that I see some, you know, a diamond in the rough kind of thing. I can see that he can do some things. He's got obvious power, but he's willing to get rangy in there when he had to. He showed some interest in body punching, which for a guy who's known as a puncher doesn't necessarily translate into a young guy's career who falls in love with his own power. They usually come out head hunting. He was able to change his attack during the course of the fight, showed us some different things, some varied attacks, so I did like that about him.
Yeah, I noticed he's got a decent boxing foundation. He's got his balance there. The hand and foot placement is correct. And I think he has more than a passing interest in the body. I think he is focused on the body attack, and I like that.
Yep, and it'll be a good night. And I see some of the comments that are being left tonight. Let me just give you this. Thompson Boxing, if you come into the fight, you do have to show a vaccination card.
Right.
But if you're not vaccinated, you just have to provide a negative COVID test within 72 hours. And if you haven't had one, they're providing a COVID test for you here where you can get a rapid test to get in.
Amazing.
So if you're going to complain about it, don't complain too soon, because we are providing resources for you to get in the building. So they are there for you. So
I thought that was fantastic. I passed there when I passed down the hallway today, and there they were doing COVID testing
right
there.
That's good for them to
know. That's a good thing.
Yeah.
All right, so there you go. So appreciate everybody leaving the comments and checking it out. Troy Williams, when are you coming back to Sacramento? Bro, I know you're asking for a friend. We're just trying to get through Ontario first. There are different jurisdictions, different counties. Obviously, look, I work in a lot of different sports, so when you're in Orange County, there's one thing. I do high school stuff in Orange County, there's different rules. LA County, there's different rules. We're just happy to be able to provide the fights for you, the fans, and also providing the fights for you here. As we are getting everything for you.
And I will say, when I was hired to do this a month ago or so, they said, can you send us your proof of vaccination
yep.
to sit here and work?
Yeah, because Rich, you live in Reno, Nevada, so it's a lot of different things. A lot of things we're trying to figure out. But regardless, though, we have the fights for you. And then, as always, the precaution from the commission to get everything for you available. And that's what they're doing right now. They're talking to Lázaro Vargas. He's going to be talking with Jessica Rosales in a couple of minutes, and we're here with you guys. So, as always, go and check everything out. Boxing Rich on Twitter. Dougie Fisher, F-I-S-C-H-E-R. Javier Razo, Razo Dog. If you guys ever go to a Rams game, go to his tailgate, tell him that Rich Murata sent you. He will feed you.
An Italian food.
Yeah, he will take care of you. Also, Razo, Golden Boy Matchmaker, Rams fan extraordinaire. And Doug, right now, you have a new podcast. I saw that. What's going on? What is it? Plug it.
Yeah, Blue Moon Entertainment. It's called In the Blue Corner.
In the Blue Corner. And, you know, Jessica Rosales is standing by with Lázaro Vargas.
All right, guys, we have joining us now Lázaro Vargas, who keeps his undefeated record intact after that win. So, Lázaro, let's talk about tonight's fight. And tell me about, how would you grade your performance out there?
It was like out of 10, like a 4 or 5. Because what I have learned is that every fight I'm getting more experience, and every fight, it's I'm learning little by little, getting my experience, and it's just like
now giving yourself such a low score. You know, you gave yourself about a 4 or 5 out there tonight. Is that because you feel like you should have had him out of there instead of going the distance with someone like that?
Well, I felt like I could have knocked him out, but I honestly, it's every fight we learn new experience. He could have taken a punch. But I think I could have knocked him out.
Seeing an opponent like that who is pretty relentless, you know, he didn't stay down. He definitely comes to fight tonight. How do you change your game plan for somebody like that who, you know, is in there for the battle?
Well, every fight is a new experience. We're learning each fight little by little. We're learning new things in the gym. And then we just have to go back to the gym and then learn new things with my coach. And I'm just grateful that Thompson gives me fights to stay active, and I'm really thankful for my trainer, my trainers, and my team, and everybody.
And let's talk about that team. Of course, everyone's supporting you from that Coachella Valley. You had some pretty good cheers out there as you were walking out here. Anything you want to say to everybody that came out to support you tonight and is supporting you at home right now?
I just want to say thank you very much, and I'm going to be back soon, and we're going to keep learning little by little. We're going to get better. We're just getting started.
Sounds good. Thank you so much for the time.
Thank you.
All right, send it back to you guys.
Good. Good kid, Lázaro Vargas. And you hear how nervous he is doing the interview. And that's great, because that's what the Thompson Boxing shows are all about, where these kids are getting exposure on camera. They're getting exposure on a broadcast. They're also learning how to do interviews afterwards, because when I talked to him in the locker room, good personality, he's all right. Fired up. His dad, he and his dad, Lázaro Sr., talking about how they used to go to the gym together. And then all of a sudden, these fighters, right, Rich? They can do anything in the ring. They will go at it and scrap, but you put a camera on and a microphone, it's like a shell,
turn
right?
Into like little
but
mouses.
This is great. This is great for them. It's good exposure.
That ring is their home. That ring is where they feel at home. They feel comfortable, you know. Like,
but as they progress, if they're destined for 8-rounders and 10-rounders and, you know, main events and televised bouts, they got to get comfortable in front of that camera.
Yeah.
And talking to somebody with a microphone.
And it's also learning to talk after you just went 4 good rounds and you're trying to catch your breath. And it's like, oh, what's going on? And by the way, he said little by little, shout out to also Tonio Diaz, who one day on our podcast told me, it was gradually or little by little. I don't know which one it is. Like, Tonio, little by little and gradually, you might be on the same path. There we go. We'll have 3 more fights coming your way. Stick with us here on the Facebook, on the YouTube, as we have this promo video for you here from Thompson Boxing.
All right, fight fans, let's get the next party started. Please welcome out of the red corner from Baja California, Tijuana, Mexico, Manuel Martinez.
I'm not even going to pretend like I know this song. It's called Por Mi Mexico, Lefty SM, and Santa Fe Clan. It's got a beat. It's going good. And I told you, Manuel Martinez is the guy who marches his own drummer, in this case, his own band. He's 6-4-4, 3 KOs, Tijuana, Mexico. Rich Morata, this guy reminds me of, just give me some gloves. I'll fight you. I don't care.
Yeah, he looks like he wants to get in there.
I was back there, Doug, and asked him a couple questions. He just gave me a nod. I'm like, okay, you know I'm asking you in Spanish, right?
Right. Young. He's a teenager still, huh?
Yep.
19, yeah.
Turned pro, what, at 16? doesn't know which corner to go to and doesn't really care.
And now please welcome his opponent out of the blue corner from San Marino, California. Please welcome Esteban Stonehands Munoz.
Got a good crowd here tonight. Hijos de Leva, humo tranquilizante. Oh, we should do a podcast, Rich Murata and Doug, about ringwalk music. What you've heard in the evolution over the years.
I don't know if you ever saw the Mike Tyson, when Mike Tyson fought Michael Spinks, if you ever get a chance to watch that tape on YouTube.
Yeah, it's not Mike music, comes it's just out this to, ominous
it's,
sound.
It's a noise.
Yeah, it's just noise, yeah.
It was just some, I don't know, I can't even describe it, but
ominous.
It was not
music.
It was scary.
Foreboding.
Let's go, Senator Franco.
Ladies and gentlemen, Thompson Boxing's New Blood continues on with the next bout of the evening. Scheduled for four rounds of action in the junior welterweight division. At ringside, your three judges score the bout should it go the distance are Fernando Villarreal, Max DeLuca, and Eddie Hernandez. And the man in charge of the action at the bell, your referee, Rudy Berrigan. Fight fans, here we go. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner. He stepped to the ring tonight where the white trunks are trimmed with red. When he stepped up to the scale, he weighed officially at 141.4 pounds. As a professional, his record stands 6 victories against 4 defeats with 4 bouts even. 3 of his wins come to you by way of KO. Ladies and gentlemen, damas y caballeros de Baja California, Tijuana, Mexico, introducing Manuel Martinez. And introducing his opponent, fighting out of the blue corner. He steps on the ring tonight where the red trunks are trimmed away. When he stepped onto the scale, he weighed officially at 141.6 ready pounds. As a professional, his record stands 4 victories against 1 defeat. 2 of those victories coming to you by way of KO. Ladies and gentlemen, from San Bernardino, California, please welcome Esteban Stonehands. Once again, your referee in charge, Rudy Berrigan, to get the final instructions.
Rudy Berrigan, the third man in the ring. As we get ready for this one, let's look at the tail of the tape for this fight, our second one of the night.
All right, let's see how these junior welterweights match up. Well, Martinez is the younger man by 7 years at age 19. He's the taller man, and he has a slight reach advantage.
All right, so I'm looking at the comments on YouTube, also the comments on el Facebook. Solo toda la gente que nos está mirando. Camilo, ¿cómo estamos? Compton Boxing checking in right now. Danny Zamora, trainer extraordinaire, manager, checking in right now. I'm surprised Danny's not at one of his kids' soccer games. So this should be a good one. Scheduled for 4 rounds. Munoz in the red, trained by Henry Ramirez. And then, of course, had Chris Areola does a great job at his gym in Riverside. Martinez.
Proud to wear that Dodger hat.
Oh,
it's Henry Ramirez.
I don't even know if he has hair or not because he already has that Dodger hat.
That's true.
I've never seen him without that hat.
Yeah, you're right.
So leave the comments and make sure you share on Facebook and on YouTube. Munoz with the bright red gloves, goes to the body, gets hit with the left hook.
You see Munoz blinks after he takes that left hook, but he just does that when he boxes. He blinks. It doesn't mean that,
is that what he does?
He's hurt or anything. It's just what you call a nervous tick, I guess.
Rico Ramos checking in. What's up, Rico? Troy Williams says, I like the new app. Make sure everybody download the Thompson Boxing app, not just to watch the fights. A good right hand by Munoz. Stung the Mexican. Goes to the body. 1-2 for the body for Munoz.
That's nice.
Overhand right by Stonehands.
Stonehands has a nice, short right hand, and he can counter with it, as Martinez found out. I was about to say Martinez, his energy and his confidence is a lot better than the last time we saw him 2 months ago against our headliner tonight, Madueño. A Madueño was just too strong, too powerful, too experienced for him. He was brave. You know, he held up as long as he could. But here he's being dissected.
Body shot.
Woo!
Body shot.
Got him. That's that short right hand.
Yeah, he's with it, and he goes right back down. And that's it. Done. A first round stoppage for Munoz.
Way to go, Munoz. A guy with just 5 pro fights equals the feat of our headliner tonight, Madueño, who had like 23 professional fights when he took out Martinez in 1 round.
And, you know, Esteban, he got a late start into boxing. He's certainly no teenager. But to throw that kind of a body shot at this stage in his career, to score a knockout with a body shot like that,
You recall, Madueño had to just overwhelm him with pressure and volume and hit him with everything. Munoz was surgical in there. He threw the right punch at the right time. He was being an economical, accurate puncher, and he ends the fight with that right to the body.
And it's one thing to get hit in the body. You know, he stood up, and as soon as he stood up, those legs got wobbly quick, and he went right back down. We'll be back with more here from Thompson Boxing in Ontario, California.
Discover the advantages of the Henry Fortifiber 1-2-3 Moisture Control System. It's as simple as 1-2-3. Choose the weather barrier, add the flashing, then finish up with the Henry Moist Top Sealant. Done. No guessing, no gambling. Just the winning confidence you get from our compatible systems.
Ladies and gentlemen, the end comes. 1 minute, 50 seconds of round number one. Referee Rudy Bargan puts a stop to this contest, declaring your winner by way of KO from San Bernardino, California, Esteban Stonehands Munoz.
Body shot ends it in the first round for Stonehands. Rich, you were saying he doesn't like the nickname?
All right, I'm going to let it slide and now another fight.
Living up to it.
Yeah,
there it is. Keep the comments coming. And, you know, Juan says, hey, commercials? Damn right we got commercials here on Thompson Boxing, bro. We got to pay some bills here. Jose Soler, I see your comment about the cameras. Let me tell you something. We are working really hard, okay? It's a club show. It's a free club show. The comments have been addressed. We're working on it, but you also got to realize, like, we got teenagers working the cameras, all right? So we're gonna get there. But it's also a free show. and we will have it for you. Two more fights coming your way. And it's also, Jose, let me just give you the behind the scenes. Normally on a broadcast, you would have a crew of about 10 to 15 people working in a production truck. We got two. But we do have two Hall of Famers. Rich Murata, California Boxing Hall of Fame. Doug Fisher, the newest inductee into the West Coast Boxing Hall of Fame. We're here right now. See, I'm waving. We're here ringside. We're taking care of you guys. So we will bring it for you, everything you need. We will have interviews with every single fighter. And coming up next is going to be Eros Correa from Salinas, California, against El Cuete Japonés, who's going to be fighting. So we will have that coming for you next. So two more fights. We will have it for you. Let's see here.
I like seeing those zeros in the records, too, of these next fighters.
Yeah, two undefeated fighters coming up next.
You know, the ring announcers like to say someone's O has got to go. But
sounds
it's not
good.
Enough.
Sounds
it's
good.
A zero.
It's
but
a zero.
Someone's zero has got to go just doesn't work, right? Just
that. Journalism professor Rich Murata is coming in. And a man with a master's degree, Doug Fisher, editor-in-chief of Ring Magazine. We're here. And a young lady who has a degree in broadcast journalism from Cal State Northridge, Jessica Rosales, is at the desk.
All right, guys, joining us now, we do have Esteban Munoz, who just put on a pretty impressive performance there and, of course, made it a pretty quick night. It was like you almost were just done, right? You were like, I'm going to make this a quick night. Tell us about that first round knockout.
Well, you know, I knew that he came in like a little soft from his body, so that I specifically aimed there to, you know, I knew he was gonna fold for sure. And I just trying to take these hand wraps off, so that's why I knocked him out pretty fast. But yeah, no, he had a little pop though, like, but nothing where I felt like I was in danger or anything like that.
So obviously you saw, I guess you would say, the weakness in your opponent when you came in, saying he was a little bit soft. Did you think that this night was going to end this quickly though?
Honestly, I didn't. I thought he would last like at least the round or something like that, but. I mean, I knew I was going to get him out for sure in the first, second round. I wanted to outdo Madueño, actually, because he knocked him out in the first round, too. So I was like, man, he knocked him out in the first round. I got to knock him out in the first round.
You know, and that's actually something that our crew had talked about, is that it actually took Madueño a lot more fights in his professional career before he was able to do that. You know, you have much less than what he did, and you were able to do the same thing in that first round. So what for you is next now that you're able to knock guys out like him in the first round?
I don't know, man. I want to take it a step at a time, and then see. I want to speak to my coach and see what we got next. You know, I can't just base that performance and then just leap to like something that I shouldn't. You know, that's what got me a loss the first time. You know, and I'm not trying to do that again. So we're just gonna take one fight at a time, and then we'll figure it out from there.
Sounds like you're being a little bit more strategic with your next steps.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I want to fight. Honestly, I want to go more rounds. I want to fight tougher guys than this guy, but. I mean, whatever's next is next, you know?
And so another thing that I want to ask you about is, you know, obviously tonight you had a crowd out here for you. Tell us about that and the support that you have behind you.
Oh, man, you know, it feels amazing to have a crowd again because I've already fought like probably like 3-4 times without a crowd. And my first fight, actually, I had a big crowd as well. And then it felt good, man, just being out there and seeing the fans and then the roars and everything when you hit them, and then you just hear the fans, the oohs and ahs and stuff like that, and it's amazing, man. I really love this feeling. So
you got some of the oohs and the ahs tonight, I would say, right?
A little bit, whatever it lasted.
So anything you want to say to everybody that's watching us at home, whether it is on YouTube, Facebook, on our new app, what do you want to say to everybody that is supporting you?
First of all, I'd like to thank everybody who made this possible, and then everybody who bought tickets, and whoever couldn't buy tickets and is tuned in at home, I thank you guys as well. And just keep an eye out for me, man.
Good. You can head out and take those wraps off now. Relax those hands a little bit. Thank you for the time. Congrats on the win. All right, guys, we are going to keep the action moving tonight. Of course, we got our co-main that is going to be coming up, one that we have talked about because it is a battle of undefeated fighters. Eros Correa saying that this could be the fight of the night. Katsuma Akitsugi saying he is at that level that he is ready to take on tougher guys. So here now is a look back at the weigh-in for our co-main event.
White fans, let's get the action going. Oh, once again, please welcome out of the red corner from Hollywood, California, Katsuma El Crete Japonosito Akitsugi.
All right, so you hear the Spanish music, right? You hear the Mexican music? And you're like, wait, is his name Akitsugi? Yes, he's Japanese. El Cuete, little firecracker. Japonesito, the little Japanese firecracker, Rich Murata. Katsuma Akitsugi, who's from Japan, now living and training in Hollywood, California. Eddie's boxing crew is who he's with. Started with them as an amateur. Here he is, a pro. Good personality. And arigato to everybody watching us, especially his mom and dad in Japan. He said he hasn't seen them in a while because he's just here training. Hiroshi and Tairumi are his parents.
And he really loves it. You know, he loves getting his moment in the sun. Yeah. He loves being on these cards. He's very grateful to Thompson Boxing for promoting. And he always says, I want to keep fighting for Thompson Boxing, be featured on their cards.
So his last three bouts were Thompson Boxing shows.
He's fun.
Yeah, he appreciates the activity.
And now please welcome his opponent from San Jose, California, Eros Correa.
That's right, San Jose, California, Eros Correa. Se creen bravos. They think they're brave. They think they're bad, Rich Murata. That's the song he's coming out to. And I don't know him. I Shazam them all. I ain't even going to pretend to know. good kid, good personality. It's been a year since he fought. We saw him fight. Doug, we saw him at the Stormhouse in Salinas.
Yeah.
We're out there with the Garcias. Took care of us up there. Shout out to them. Main sparring partner at times of Ruben Villa.
Oh, that's as good a sparring as you can hope for in preparing for a southpaw technician.
So this should be a good one. It's Friday night, and we're watching boxing. You're right there, Juanelos G. It's Friday, we're watching boxing. We know there's a Laker game going on. We know there's baseball going on. And we know if you're watching with us, we appreciate you all the time.
Ladies and gentlemen, Thompson Boxing's New Blood Series is proud to present the co-main event of the evening, scheduled for 8 rounds of action in the Super Bantamweight Division. At ringside, your three judges scoring the bout should it go the distance are Fernando Villarreal, Max DeLuca, and Eddie Hernandez. And the man in charge of the action at the bell, your referee, Rudy Barragan. Fight fans, here we go. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner. He steps to the ring tonight wearing white trunks with red. When he steps onto the scale, he weighed officially at 119.5 ready pounds. As a professional, he steps in the ring tonight undefeated. 6 wins with 0 losses. One of his victories coming to you by way of KO. Ladies and gentlemen, introducing from Hollywood, California, here is Katsuma El Cuete Japonesito Akitsugi. And introducing his opponent, fighting across the ring out of the blue corner. He steps in the ring tonight wearing the red trunks triple black. When he stepped onto the scale, he went officially at 120.7 solid pounds. Tonight, he too enters the ring undefeated. 10 wins with 0 losses. 7 of his victories coming to you by way of KO. Ladies and gentlemen, introducing from San Jose, California, here is Eros Correa. Once again, you're in charge, Rudy Benetton, to get the final instructions.
You both got your instructions. Okay. You need to protect yourselves at all times and obey my commands at all times. 8 rounds, guys. Let's go.
Rudy Barragan, the third man in the ring. Let's look at the tell the tape, Rich Murata.
All right, as you can see, Akitsugi much younger than is Correa, but everywhere you take a look here, there's really not much to choose. We're just going to get a good, honest,
chess match here, I think, between these two who have considerable skills on both sides.
That's a good way to put it. Both guys are boxers. Akitsugi is more of the technician who has to be busier, and Correa is the guy with the amateur background, so he's more of a stick-and-move boxer.
This is our co-main. Our main event will be Miguel Angel Madueño de Guasave taking on La Boa de Monterrey, José Luis Rodríguez. That's going to be the main event next. Anthony Chavez and Brandon Benitez was canceled because Chavez woke up with an abscess tooth, actually went to the ER and was taken off of the car. So for those of you asking about him, and also Gucci Mane, who Joel Diaz trains, his opponent was unable to continue so with the physicals, so he was taken off the car. That's why there's only four of them tonight, but they're a good one. This is our co-main, Eros Correa, in the black and gray. He's undefeated, 10-0, 7 KOs. Katsuma Akitsugi, 6-0, only one KO, but he trains with Eddie's boxing crew. And I asked him, Eddie, what's the deal? And Rich, you're gonna like this. He said, we didn't go to Tijuana and buy fighters and knock them out and build up a record. We've been fighting tough shows here, and we've been fighting in bigger weight classes. So this is one of the first times that he's down at 119. A couple times, Doug, we saw him, he was at 26.
That's right.
Just to get fights.
He's finding a home for his left early in this opening round. Correa landed a straight right to the body. Akitsugi paid him back in kind with a straight left to Correa's body.
And that punch by Akitsugi was very sharp. That was a really sharp punch.
Eros Correa works as a security guard and also as a boxing coach trainer.
Yeah, how about that? He loves to work with kids.
Yep.
Teaching them the sport.
What up, Roca Sports? He's watching this right now. Oh, these shots are thuds.
Akitsugi actually acknowledged the power of the punch. He gave him a little nod.
Yeah, that was a good one there. You're watching us on a Friday night. I guess the Lakers are doing terrible. The Astros won. And we're here for you. Free boxing coming your way. What up, Nick Martin? Checking us out. Ermin Mariscal down the street. What's this down the street? Get here. This is a good scrap and blood from the mouth of Akitsugi. That's not his mouthpiece. That is some blood.
It's anybody's round with 40 seconds to go. Both guys have landed short shots.
And you can hear it. If Paul, if you could turn down the audio in the building, that'd be pretty cool because it is getting loud in here. We have the cool headsets, but it is loud in the hotel ballroom. This is a good club fight. It's scheduled for 8 rounds, going to come your way. These guys, you know, and Doug, we've talked about it. Not many times do you have an undefeated fighter willing to fight another undefeated fighter, but neither of them have a promoter. So, Rich, they got to get after it.
And that's the thing, because promoters, if they have two undefeated fighters, are rather reluctant to put them together.
But they'll put two guys who are free agents. Why not? And we, the fans, appreciate it. Good opening round.
Yes, sir.
That's fun. Y saludos al primo Chubbs. Mi primo Oscar, que está en Guadalajara, desde Nochislán, Zacatecas. And why don't you guys drop where you're watching it from? If you're at one of the Thompson Building Materials in Orange, Fontana, Camarillo, San Diego, Ripon, Sacramento. Always go to ThompsonBLDG.com if you need any building materials. Randall Flagg said, hard round to call.
Yeah, I like that round.
I scored it even.
I can't pick a winner from watching that round.
I thought about it. I was like, you know what, 10-10.
Gigi Monet says, hey, 10-10 round also. All right, so I'm watching the YouTube feed and the Facebook feed. So if you guys leave comments, go for it. Way different from when you used to do the forum boxing on Prime Ticket, right, Rich Murata? Imagine Tom Kelly interacting with the fans. The late, great Tom Kelly.
I think he would have liked it. I think he could do it.
Yeah, because Tom can command a room.
He commands
a broadcast. He can command an arena.
If you're a young fight fan, do yourself a favor. Just YouTube forum boxing, and you'll hear Rich on the call with the great Tom Kelly, and it was a lot of fun.
That voice. That was the sportscaster voice.
Yes, it was.
Joe Angel Zamora checking in for Santa Fe Springs. Don't worry, Joe Angel, I'm going to vote for you again in 2 years. City Council member from Santa Fe Springs. Blackhawk 66 checking in Cape Coral, Florida. What's happening?
You know, Correa was an Olympic alternate, but in 2012, think of that. That's 9 years ago.
Yeah. Think about his contemporaries like Jamel Herring, who's fighting tomorrow. A world champion at 130 pounds.
Right.
Jojo Diaz, who won a world title at 130 pounds and is going to be challenging for the lightweight title against Devin Haney, looks like.
I think Caleb Plant was involved in that World Series of Boxing as well, as was Correa.
Yeah, but you would think, you know, his career would be more advanced
exactly.
by the age of 28 after having been such a standout amateur. And I looked at his amateur record on BoxRec, and he's got two wins over Stephen Fulton.
Really?
Who was a 122-pound champion, yep. getting ready to fight in a title unification bout.
It's the business of boxing. It you never know where you're going to take you.
That's a great point, Nebeto, because some guys can just slip through the cracks.
Yeah. Well, and some guys are just better suited for the amateur ranks. If you remember Pepe Riley, remember him?
Sure. Oh, yeah.
As an amateur.
Clash of heads.
Uh-oh. That's happening.
Okay.
But Pepe Riley was a contemporary of Shane Mosley and Oscar De La Hoya.
Really? He
they
was?
They were all on the 1990, or no, actually, Mosley didn't make the 1992 Olympic squad. He got beat out for that spot against Vernon Forrest. But Riley actually made the squad, and he was on the team with Oscar De La Hoya, but he wasn't suited for the professional ranks. He's a trainer now at Wildcard Boxing Club.
Mighty Bell Ramos watching in Pacoima saying, vamos cuete. Stacks, Anthony Saldana watching in Whittier with his boy Gus. Danny Mazzamora checking in. A good scrap. Look at this. This is fun.
Yeah, it's getting kind of rough right now.
Yep. Oh, Rudy pushing him back. How about Rudy? Rudy's been working out. Rudy, but
yeah, he doesn't know his own strength.
Well. Well, that's one way to get the fighter back.
Yep.
I have seen fighters hit referees, yep. so.
Horatio Ware in Compton in the house. Francisco Lopez in Guadalajara, Mexico. Final seconds of the second round.
I was not expecting to see a roughhouse battle the way this has become a pure sixer now suddenly.
Yeah. There you go, when the crowd likes it. Evans, Cali Boxing in the 408, that's right. Cali Boxing where Eros Correa does work when he's getting some time in. And if you're watching for the first time, you're like, why are you guys talking? Because we interact with you. We know that you're watching the fight, so you can see it, but we're having the conversation with you. This is like you being able to enjoy the fight with two Hall of Famers, and you get that.
Yeah, you don't need us to call out every punch, but I'll do so in this replay right here. Actually, it's grappling. This is what the second round showing us that inadvertent shove from Rudy Barragan.
Katsuma looked at Rudy and goes, hey, I got a tough enough guy in front of me. I don't need you pushing me, too.
The second round was just as difficult to score as the first round, but for different reasons. First round, hotly contested. Both guys landed their big shots. The second round, more grappling. Their styles did not clash in a good way.
Clover Games watching this in Johnson City, Tennessee. They had a minor league baseball team there, a buddy of mine used to play for. Randall Flagg said, I missed the prime ticket days, but it's fun interacting with you guys. And it's interaction between Cuete and Eros Correa as they're standing in the middle just going after each other. You don't have to find them. And Rudy Barragan letting them work. The southpaw is El Cuete Aponcito, who's his sponsor is falling off of his trunks in the back of his trunks.
I might have to tear that thing off.
Yep.
But something tells me the more wild it gets, that suits Akitsugi more than it suits Correa. My thought coming in was that Correa, with that amateur background and his power, he is a better puncher, but I think that power shows itself from long distance or mid-range with his right hand. So if he's smothering himself and they're grappling in there, I think that suits Akitsugi.
And I think Akitsugi is more exciting in this fight than he was in the previous fight.
Mario Caraveo watching us at Albuquerque, New Mexico. Right away, you think Johnny Tapia, Albuquerque, right?
Danny Romero.
Danny, oh, Little Red.
Holly Holm.
Oh, yeah.
That
same area.
Great tradition.
G. Monet, what's up in Santa Ana? Yeah, home of Ronnie Rios and Alexis Rocha. Venezuela watching us. Saludos, Tony Alfonso.
Herrera getting a little wild with that right hand.
And this is what I was talking about with undefeated fighters not wanting to fight each other at times because you have a scrap like this. But if you want to get out of the club circuit, you got to go through this. Right, Rich?
That's exactly right. And Well, let the action speak for itself right there. But one thing about Correa, he really, he's shown a varied attack in the past, but he felt that his best punch was a jab. But in there against this southpaw, he's finding it very difficult to jab at all.
He's not jabbing. He's just putting his hand out there to measure him for the right hand. Oh, and there is the right hand right there. He needs more of that.
Another solid right. Body work from El Cuete. The Japanese fighter in white wings his punches. This is one scheduled for 8. And the way it's going and the pace that it's at, you're going to wonder about conditioning too as the fight progresses.
And we know Akitsugi has a good engine. I think his stamina is very good. And he's the guy who's had the activity coming into this fight, whereas Correa has had a year off.
And if you are not blessed with great power, and that's the situation with Akitsugi, you've got to be exciting. You've got to be a volume puncher.
Right.
You've got to have people get involved in your fight. And you can hear from these fans, they're involved in this fight.
Akitsugi only one KO in his young career. And he's in a fire fight tonight against Eros Correa. Let's see here. Fidel Avendano say, watching again from the Talking Again podcast studios. What's up, Fidel? Theo Lacey. Jaime Alberto Flores says, so good to hear Rich talking boxing again. And there you see El Boa Rodriguez coming in to the building. He's our main event coming up next. Bobby Foster from Albuquerque. And there you see Madueño. No emotion from the guy with the beard. And then you put him in the ring and he just throws punches and bunches and unloads. That'll be our main event coming up next, and it's a good one.
You know, he kind of reminded me, I'm not talking about in style, but just in reputation, of when Ingemar Johansson came from Sweden to fight Floyd Patterson. And I remember, and I've seen it on the, I don't remember, but I've seen it on YouTube, on the film of it, the announcer Chris Schenkel at the time saying the mystery man from Sweden.
Right.
And when Madueño came here, I referred to him as the mystery man from Mexico,
right,
because
all
he has all these knockouts,
yeah,
but we don't know.
All we know is that he's got a punch. That's it.
He's from Wasabi, Sinaloa. That's the city close to him. He's like, yeah, I'm about half hour away on a farm. I'm like, where? He's like, I pulled it up on my phone. You know, Google in Maps comes up with everything. Didn't show up. That's where he's from.
He's off the grid.
Drew Mejia, TKO Boxing Club, checking us in right now. Eros Correa with his fan club here. Eros brings a crowd here. Gavin Akunmonu watching us in Australia. You're watching the good one. Eros Correa in red and gray. Katsumi Akitsugi, Japanese fighter, El Cuete Japonesito in white with the red trim.
See, I think Correa should be doing what he's doing right now is utilizing some lateral movement. You stand, if you come right at Akitsugi, he loves it. You don't want to back up against him. You want to circle him and see if he can cut that ring off. We don't know if he can do so yet.
That left for Akitsugi, it lands, but it's not landing flush.
You know, we got a hell of a scrap going on here, and yet I'm still distracted by that sponsor sign that's it's held on by scotch tape on the back of
it. It is.
Trunks.
It's the fourth round. When will that sponsorship fall off? And Eros Correa, who hasn't fought since November of last year, almost a year, you know, young fighter, but at the same time, Doug, it's a year, and I was like, what happened? Like, well, they would call for fights, but it never really went anywhere. That's got to be frustrating, too, because activity is what you need.
Yeah, and it's too bad, because his last fight, he was in with another undefeated opponent, and he won it. He won an 8-round majority decision. That was against Henry Arredondo,
yep,
and it was a good back-and-forth fight. I think Arredondo was announced the winner, but one of the judges made a mistake on the scorecard, so they went to commercial, and when they came back, they said, oh, our bad,
yeah.
Correa.
And before that, he fought in the world-famous Big Punch Arena. I was like, why? He said, I just needed a fight. I just needed some activity. In Tijuana, shout out to Tim Boxeo. Yeah.
From Big Punch Arena to Staples Center.
Yes, he did.
Bit of a jump.
Juan Salcido watching us in Wasabi. Saludos a los de Wasabi. Bueno, sí, después de esta pelea.
It seems to me that Correa is initiating these clinches. And I don't know why that is unless he's, you know, he's feeling tired. He just caught a two-piece right there.
That's the clinch we're talking about right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, that's him. He's initiating it.
I was beginning to
that
suspect
counts against him in my book. Like, if you're the one who's tying up all the time, there's a reason for that. And tying a guy up is not fighting.
Rudy called time. What are we looking for? Oh, a piece of the sponsorship fell down. Oh. A piece of the paper fall. Okay, so the fourth, a piece of the paper from the sponsorship is falling. Good fight. Edgar Burgos watching in Pacoima. Javier Ramos watching Pacoima. Not my Richie, of course. I see all the comments coming through. The next fight for Thompson Boxing is scheduled in December. Download the Thompson Boxing app and you'll get all the information on what's going on. Also, exclusive interviews with the fighters. And it's cool to see the Thompson Boxing fighters here. You have Richard Brewer in attendance. Ace Torres in attendance. Sal Sanchez in attendance. Isaac Zarate, who was supposed to be on the card tonight but got sick. He was scratched. He's still in attendance. Rialto, California, checking us out. Doug, are you keeping an unofficial card on this one?
I am. I have a really close fight. I've got Akitsugi up by 1.39-38.
Okay.
I've given him the last two rounds, but they have been very hard to score. So I have no idea, you know, what the official judges are seeing.
And the first one, you did go 10-10.
I went 10-10.
Cool.
And I don't usually allow that from any of my partners.
But that was a close round. I mean, we don't have CompuBox here, but I would imagine they landed the same number of power punches. And they were very clean, clear power punches, whether to the head or the body.
We say Jorge Garcia, hay tiro, señores, there is. There's a good fight going on right now.
But it's fallen into more of a grappling kind of awkward fight that has its flashes of excitement, like right now, a good exchange. But whenever they're in proximity, and it's usually Correa, I hate to say it, there's some hugging going on.
It's really not the fight I expected to see, though.
The first couple rounds, okay, but then we'll see.
I wasn't even expecting that hot opening round. I really thought the Correa was going to come out and punch on the fly, stick and move a little bit, and try to set up big right hands from the outside.
Akitsugi.
Akitsugi looks like he could go 10 rounds tonight.
And he likes it. Yeah, he likes a physical fight.
He's enjoying the combat.
He is. So what I've heard about him, his English is getting better. He's also learning the Spanish.
Oh, Correa's got to watch those low blows. He's trying to aim towards that cup with some of these clinches.
Yeah, Akitsugi, I like the learning of the Spanish. Yeah, that's good. It worked well for Triple G.
It did.
Well, Triple G had phrases.
Yeah.
And then once he got after the Canelo, he went back to the I need my translator.
Yep.
It's like, yeah, okay. Good left from El Cuete.
But I have to admit, I did love the Mexicans for Golovkin t-shirts.
That was a shout-out to Mr. Boxing Guru, who was a Canelo hater, so he made the which is good, which is great. Like, yeah. You know, if you pick your guy, that's the beauty about boxing.
You pick
your guy, whether you're picking Fernando or Oscar Trinidad or Bernard, whatever it is, you go with your guy. And there you have after it. Right now, Katsuma Akitsugi in the white, landing a good 1-2.
Is that a head clash?
And then I see where Correa dug, and you're seeing it more and more. He's the one grabbing.
Yes, he is. And he's the one who's looking a little bit ragged, a little bit worse for wear. And it's because he's languishing on the inside and getting out-hustled on the inside by the Japanese fighter. And the Japanese fighter has landed very well to the body. There's a nice left hand upstairs. I'll tell you what, round five is a clear round for Akitsugi in my book.
That might be the first time we have a clear round.
He's indefatigable. He's just, he's like a rock'em sock'em robot toy.
Konnichiwa to everybody in Japan watching us. It's Saturday morning in Japan, and people are talking about Friday night fights on ESPN. Of course, we used to love watching that. Saturday, though, you're going to have Jamel Herring and Shakur Stevenson going after it. Bernardo Osuna, a good friend of ours, will be there in Atlanta calling that fight. I just love, though, Rich, that they're going to different cities. I know you've done that before in different cities. It used to be Vegas.
Gentlemen, they found a cell phone. If you lost your cell phone tonight, check your pockets, check your purse.
So they found the
if
cell phone.
If you lost a cell phone, could be an iPhone or an Android, it's located at Will Call. Once again, if you lost your cell phone tonight, go see Will Call to claim your phone. Thank you.
You know, Thompson has gone to Sacramento. We've gone to Salinas. But last week there was an ESPN show in San Diego. You're starting to see different cities. Miami making that comeback.
Yeah.
Bringing the fights to different cities, I think, is just so cool now.
What's the most fun you've had going to another city?
Believe it or not, Montreal.
Montreal.
Doug and I were in Montreal for David Lemieux fight. It was a lot of fun.
Sure was.
You know, for me, it was doing a fight in Dublin.
Whoa. Ooh, yeah.
With the Pocket Rocket, Wayne McCulloch.
Oh, yeah.
Against Jose Luis Bueno.
Wow.
And didn't Bueno give him a real tough fight?
It was a tremendous fight. And that crowd was unbelievable.
McCulloch, Wayne was was worthy of that kind of adulation. He really was.
Pocket Rocket.
Swell guy, too.
Olympian.
That's
great,
right.
Dude.
That's right. Olympic silver medalist.
Saludos, Atlante, que está esperando el Boa. El Boa sigue después esta la titular. And right now, Akitsugi, the Japanese fighter, El Cuete Japonesito, looking good. The southpaw in white.
Yeah, Akitsugi is the aggressor, and he's the busier fighter. But most importantly, he's landing more punches than Correa is.
Real quick, throwback to McCulloch. Do you know who he lost to in the 92 Olympics?
Yes,
the gold
Joel Casamayor.
Really?
Who are you talking to here? You're going to stump Mr. Trivia?
And you're going to stump him? No, you're not, but you're watching a good fight here at Thompson Boxing. You're watching it for free. And make sure you download the Thompson Boxing app to keep updated with everything going on. And of course, shout out to Tim Boxell. The Tim Boxell podcast lets you know everything about club boxing all over the world.
Yeah, he is a great follow.
Oh, yeah. He gives you all the links to what's going on around the world. You can know what's going on and you find out. Saludos del campo, toda la gente que está mirando. We appreciate you. We know you're watching this fight. You know you're a hardcore boxing fan. You're getting a good scrap here.
This one's getting really rough. But you know what? I like that there hasn't been a point deduction.
Yeah.
I do. Let them be rough. Let them be physical. It's a contact sport.
A minute to go in the sixth round, scheduled for eight. Although I'm bouncing around.
That straight right could be a good weapon for Correa.
Yeah, he just doesn't have the range. He's not using the right tactics to set that shot up.
Because Akitsugi lunges in sometimes. It's there for him.
Yeah, he's not just a workhorse. He's a bit awkward. He's not just a southpaw volume puncher. He's kind of got his own rhythm.
And everybody's saying Tim Boxill for life. Exactly. If you're a hardcore fan.
That was a power jab from Akitsugi.
Yes,
I like
it was.
That.
This is the kind of scrap that Tim Boxill will help you out. I got a shirt. And this is what it is. Club show, back and forth action. 10-0, Eros Correa putting his zero on the line, Rich Murata.
There you go.
El Cuete putting his zero on the line at 6-0. And it's a good one. As we head to the seventh here in Ontario. They hit gloves. I like that. They know this is a good scrap. Cheeseball says, very sloppy fight. Yeah, man, but it's getting sloppy, but it's fun, right?
Hey, man, Tyson Fury, Deontay Wilder 3. Everyone's saying it's fight of the year. Guess what? A lot of slop in that one.
It was sloppy, man.
Come on.
But it was fun.
It was fun. It was entertaining. This is entertaining.
Bro, how many fights have we seen where they're boring?
Yeah. Yeah, it's technically clean, but boring fight.
This is why I never...
I'll take sloppy and exciting over clean and boring.
Yes, indeed. And that's the corner of Eros Correa. Main event coming up next here from the Doubletree in Ontario. Eddie's boxing crew, also Panda Boxing.
This Akitsugi is in tremendous shape.
Yep.
He just looks like he can punch nonstop,
you know,
for
what?
20 rounds.
It's his conditioning, but it's also his attitude. He wants to be here.
Uh-huh.
He wants to train. He wants to be in the gym. He wants to get up there and entertain fans. And feel this energy that, you know, you're only going to get with the club fight setting.
And update on the sponsorship, it's off of the trunks. So we got to the sixth round for the sponsorship.
They got their money's worth.
I wonder if they'll only pay three quarters of the
sponsor
it's pretty
fee.
Smart, yeah. It's per round.
In boxing, what do you think it is?
Woo! Nice left hand landed by Akitsugi. Correa is initiating this clinch. And I think the referee just kind of warned him about that.
Israel Luna says, I spar Cuete. He's dedicated and crafty.
He is crafty.
Soco Rodriguez, está mirando el Cuete Japonesito en blanco, Eros Correa de Salinas, San Jose in red. That's right, Jojo Diaz was using el Cuete as a sparring partner for his fight with Fortuna.
Oh, that was probably good work, because Fortuna, also one of these unorthodox guys. He's a southpaw, but got his own rhythm. Got his own rhythm.
A good club fight coming your way here on Thompson Boxing. Good exchange. Arrows getting in and out. Wait.
Correa needs to get that jab going. Get that side-to-side movement. Let that right hand go from mid-range or from long range. Preferably long range for him. So he can get up on his toes and move around, but he's not punching on the fly.
Left lands.
And then Correa poses. He gets on it and he kind of glides around the ring. Then he just plants his feet and then he gets popped as soon as he does it.
All right, Evergreen says, Cuete didn't spar any rounds for this fight. If you're going to give me that kind of info, Ever, give me some more, bro. Don't just leave it like that. Like, you got to give me a little bit more
information. Why would that be? Why? Yeah. Why would you not spar? Especially if you've been out of the ring for almost a year.
Cuete.
Oh, Akitsugi.
Yeah.
Well, maybe with his activity, he didn't need to.
Because Correa, from what I understood, had gotten good sparring for this fight with good people.
Oh, right. You guys, at the start of the fight, you said Ruben Villa.
Yep.
Yeah.
Officer.
I have to imagine Ruben's frustrated watching his boy right now.
Yeah, he also sparred Oscar Escandon.
Yep, and that's a rough and tumble veteran right there.
Evergreen is saying that Cuete was cut 3 weeks ago.
Oh, wow, so got some inside knowledge here.
Evergreen, that's what's up. That's what you do. That's when you bring it, baby. Let me go ask the corner in between rounds. Up next, our main event, El Boa Rodriguez de Monterrey, Miguel Angel Madueño, desde Guasave, Sinaloa. All right, Evergreen, I'm going to go ask Eddie's boxing crew after this right now. So he said he was cut on the nose, and he was part of the last 3 weeks. See, this is what we do, Rich. Interact with the people, we get info. It's 2021, baby. It's different. It's a different kind of broadcast.
Evergreen says he was cut on the bridge of his nose?
Yep.
I'm not seeing it.
Oh, yeah, look.
Oh, yeah, there's a little mark there.
Okay.
Doesn't look bad. Oh, yeah.
Who would have thought, Rich,
there?
You've got thousands of color men on your telecaster.
It's a different world. But you know what? It's for that. I'll be right back.
All right. Eighth and final round.
What we have here, Doug, are two really willing battlers.
And Correa is coming out the way he needs to come out. I think he needs to win this round to have any hope of winning the fight.
I also have Akitsugi out in front in this fight, but it's been more than just competitive.
And there's been more than one round that I scored for Akitsugi that was hard to score. And I'm in particular, I'm talking about rounds 3 and 4. I scored both those rounds for Akitsugi. You can make an argument that Correa won at least one of those rounds.
All right, so I just talked to Eddie in the corner, trainer of Akitsugi. He said he was cut 3 weeks ago. We tried and he couldn't, so he didn't do any kind of sparring, just pad work for the last 3 weeks.
Wow.
Well, he's got a lot of energy in there. He's throwing a ton of punches in there.
Yep. He doesn't look rusty.
Shout out to Evergreen for giving us that information in the eighth and final round of our co-main here on Thompson Boxing.
Oh, that's a nice left hand by Akitsugi. Wow.
Yes, it is.
He He's got his timing.
I think one of his cleanest punches of the fight.
It was. Rich, you see Correa with his mouth open? Look a little tired?
Little bit, yeah. Slight suspicion of that.
But I think Correa has a part in his own fatigue with all this grappling. And if you're not a wrestler, don't engage in that stuff, because you will wear yourself out.
Well, he got the overhand right in there.
But then Akitsugi answers with a shot to the body.
That's the thing. Correa has had moments where he lands a big right hand. He was landing it well to the body in the first two rounds, but every time he lands that punch, Akitsugi, he usually comes back.
Baldo Boxing. Howard Cosell is turning on his grave with this commentary. Let me tell you this.
Howard Cosell was despised. I liked him as a kid. Yeah. But, I mean, 80% of America couldn't stand his commentary.
Let me tell you this.
The person who just said that is probably 19 years old.
No way. 19-year-olds don't know Howard Cosell.
Yeah.
Baldo Boxing.
They know the name.
Howard would tell you that he loves us.
Howard liked to work alone on fights. He wanted to work solo.
And he was a lawyer. What do you think?
Yep.
Some of his early fights when he was play-by-play man. Well, some of his early fights he was doing the analyst position.
Right.
But then when he was working with, say, Chris Schenkel, Chris found it very hard to get a word in edgewise.
Fight winding down. There you hear the 10 bell. He's going to go the distance.
I tell you, I enjoyed this.
Yeah. A lot of fun. Sloppy at times, but fun. A good club fight on a Friday night. How do you have it out there on social media? Leave your comments. See what you guys have.
Paving the way to your personal sanctuary that you simply can't stop thinking about. Find yours at Belgar.com.
Experience the world's largest compatible cordless system. Makita's LXT batteries take you from power tools to outdoor power equipment. The blower delivers power comparable to a 24cc gas model. From the job site to your home, reach speeds of 116 miles per hour. Use Makita's cordless products anytime, anywhere. One system, endless possibilities. Now get two extra free batteries.
Gentlemen, after eight rounds of boxing action, to the judges' scorecards we go. Both Max DeLuca and Ed Hernandez sees about 78-74, while Fernando Villarreal sees about 76-76, declaring the winner by majority decision and still undefeated from Hollywood, California, Katsuma. El Cuete Japonesito Akitsugi.
Good scrap, tough scrap, and Katsuma Akitsugi gets the decision on two of the cards. One of the referees had a draw. Doug Fisher, five.
Akitsugi earned it. He was the aggressor throughout. He threw more punches. He landed more punches. It's that simple. And I scored at 78-75 for Akitsugi.
I think that's a good score. And Akitsugi, I noticed him when he went back to his corner. He was smiling after the fight. He smiled sometimes during the fight. He even smiled when he got hit a couple of times.
Yes, he did.
And Doug, you hit it right when you said he brought good attitude into the bout here tonight. So I love his attitude. I like what he did tonight in terms of excitement. And he wanted to be in there. He wanted to show what he could do. And I'm sure we're going to see him back again.
Yep. Shout out to Eddie's boxing crew and Panda Boxing, who are in the corner for him. And, you know, the comments were pretty cool. Lil Tyrone, Randall Fly, everybody else in San Jose. Thank you for watching everybody in San Jose, the 408. Shout out to you guys. And Eros Correa, you know, he might have got the loss tonight. That's a tough dude, though.
Yep.
Against anybody else, he wins that fight.
Oh, he was right in there, Beto. And every round was competitive. You know, every round was competitive.
That's exactly what you want to have. One more fight. Our main event's coming your way. We're going to have an interview with Jessica Rosales. We're also going to have the national anthem. They got to clean the ring a little bit. So thanks to everybody that's still watching us right now on a Friday night here. Make sure you download the Thompson Boxing app for everything that you need. Bethel Duran, Rich Murata, and Doug Fisher. Doug, of course, the editor-in-chief of Ring Magazine. Rich Murata.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's that time of the show. We got some free stuff to give away. Boxing.
Yeah, but Sonny's all out,
we got
bro.
The Thompson Boxing ring goes into the ring. They got some stuff to give away.
I jumped 6 feet when I heard Sonny go.
Boxing fans, if you want some free stuff, you're going to make some giveaway. Giveaway, ladies, giveaway.
All right, so, and this time. They decide to turn it up as loud as possible in here right now.
Well, whenever they ask who wants free stuff, we're liable to be run over by these fans behind us here.
You want a shirt? And if you want a shirt, you can go to the Thompson Boxing app, and they'll have a shirt for you. Jessica Rosales is standing by with our winner.
All right, guys, it is definitely a bit loud in here tonight, but of course that atmosphere is matching the energy of the fight that we just saw. Now, Katsuma, you had to work for that victory tonight. Obviously, in the ring, it was a hard-fought battle for you. Tell me about tonight's fight and how that felt.
I've been through a tough situation in my life outside of the ring. And I was a little bit kind of depressed before the camp. But when I had this opportunity, I took the fight, and then I trained, and then I focused on this for this. I focused on the training, and then I tried to stop talking to my family and my friend in Japan, and then just focus on this camp. And then this, worth it. I'm so happy. I'm so glad. He was really tough. I know he was tough.
And speaking about that, you did say that this was probably the toughest opponent that you faced.
Yes.
And we did see that out there in this battle that seemed to just go back and forth. Tell me about that. And, you know, obviously he was a tough guy for you. Was he what you expected?
I couldn't box my style at all this time, but I don't care. I just win. I'm so happy that I won the fight. But next fight, try to fight my fight that I train in the gym. Yeah, but I don't want to say, just I'm happy.
When you say that you didn't fight your style tonight, why do you say that? Why is that?
I'm so tight. I was so tight. All rounds, tight. I usually relax and then pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa. I didn't do anything today. I just wanna win.
You feel like you could have let go a little bit more?
Yeah, more. I think I made myself tougher. Yeah, I fight that he fight. I should have more be smart. But, you know, I'm so happy. Estoy contento mucho.
There's a little bit of the Espanol that Beto was telling us about. I actually asked him if he is learning Spanish. And you want to say something in Spanish. ¿Quieres decir algo en español?
Sí. Muchas gracias a todos, mis familias y fans. I love you guys. I love you.
His Spanish is better than Beto Duran's. I love hearing that. Now, Katsuma Akitsugi, congratulations on the win tonight. Now, in English, do you want to say anything to the fans at home?
Tonight, a lot of people coming, so I'm so happy they came out, and then I'm glad that I brought the win tonight. I cannot describe except happy. Yes, I'm so happy. Thank you.
Congratulations on the majority win decision tonight. Katsuma Akitsugi, we will let you get off to the locker room. Go ahead and relax after a hard-fought battle tonight. Guys, we will send it back to you for more.
Oh, you know what, Jessica Rosales? Yo no sabo no españolo. But good job by Katsuma Akitsugi giving us the reactions here live here. Back here at ringside, Beto Duran, Doug Fisher, Rich Murata here with you. And Katsuma, I like that. You know, English is not easy.
No.
It's barely his second language, but he went through the interview, has a translator with him, Rich, and decided, I'll just do it myself, respect to him. And then he throws the Spanish, and it's like flowing. Maybe Spanish is his second language.
Hey, listen, then eventually that will work for him. It worked for Marco Antonio Barrera. I remember at the beginnings, Miguel Cotto would never do interviews in English, and then he came on my radio show one time, and Ricardo Jimenez, who was working with him, said he wants to do the interview with you in English. And, you know, it was tough for him, but he got through it, and of course he got better and better.
What
and
it
better.
Does is it gets the fighter's personality across to a wider audience, and usually it helps the fighter garner new fans.
Yeah, there it is. So we do see all the comments. Look, I got the Facebook here, I got the YouTube here, I'm seeing all the comments. Saludos a toda la gente que nos está mirando ahorita desde Monterrey, esperando la boa, and also in Culiacán, waiting for Madueño. And that's coming up. Our next fight, our main event, is coming up your way. As always, download the Thompson Boxing app, and we will have it for you. Paul? Yeah, all right, here we go, just making sure. And Miguel Madueño, with Doug, we've seen all of his fights here in the United States. We've called all of them except for the one that he did in Florida.
Right.
But his last fight against
Sonny Fredrickson
on Triller, we see some highlights from it. This is where we figured out, okay, this guy really is a fighter.
Yeah, he can do more than just deliver a punch. He can take a punch, and he can go rounds. He's not a front runner. He doesn't run out of gas, which is like 9 out of 10 knockout artists. You take them into deep water, what happens? They drown. Madueño showed that he could swim. And when it looked like he was running out of gas, he had a second gear, he had a second wind. He turned it up, and he got the stoppage in the final round.
And that was very important. He had to show, because Fredrickson wilted at the end. And Fredrickson's a good fighter.
It's the end. That guy can fight. Toledo tough.
Yeah. Exactly right. So that was a big win, and we learned a lot about Madueño.
And you know, Rich, when you have fighters that come from out of nowhere, you know, guys that you see in the United States for the first time, and they're knocking everybody out, all of a sudden everybody's like, yeah, he's a knockout guy.
Yeah.
But when you get tested by a Toledo tough like Lubin, you know, you learn about those guys, right? What do we expect from him moving forward?
Well, I expect that he will continue to get a little more polished with each fight. I think he's got to totally settle his trainer situation, and get someone with him who's with him all the time, with him in his corner in the fights, with him when he's training, and can really teach, because there's a lot there to work with.
Yeah, desde Guasave, Sinaloa. So if you're in Sinaloa, mande los recodos y nos digan quién lo está mirando. Also, share on Facebook and on YouTube. Let it know what's going on. That's our main event coming up next. And he has a tough opponent, and Boa Rodriguez is in Monterrey. And Doug Rodriguez, we've seen him before. This is a dude who's like, okay, I'm tough, but I'm not here to lay down either.
No, he's going to take the fight to Madueño. He's a guy who's been in there with tall, rangy punchers like Ruben Torres. Been in there with former contenders like Antonio Orozco, Jose Pedraza's been in there with Mario Barrios. He's seen everything. He's seen different styles. He's been in there with people with power and physical strength. He's not going to be intimidated tonight.
And one of the things about here on the club show, Thompson Boxing, you see him here, and you want to see these guys progress to the next level, you know, whether you're working with a matchroom boxer like Danny Roman was doing, or now that you're working at top rank, Giovanni Santillan, we've seen here, and Rich, you and I were talking about it, Santillan, he's like, at times was good, at times kind of eh, but his last fight, last weekend in San Diego, looked really good.
Yeah, and this is a guy, he didn't make the big splash, the sensation, the way that Madueño is doing, you know. This is a guy who's incrementally getting better, and they increase the level of his competition, and he keeps taking the steps and handling them. So with that being the case, now you can get him into that true contender situation, and hopefully he's going to be able to adjust and make that step as well.
And that was against a fighter that we know well, Angel Ruiz, trained by Manny Robles.
Dangerous fighter.
Yep.
Southpaw with speed and power. And when I saw this fight announced on paper, I didn't think it was 50-50. I did, Santillan's more experienced, more mature. He's fighting in his hometown, but I was like 60-40 type fight. And I thought, okay, an upset could be possible. And Santillan just dominated. And I got to tell you, it's the best I've ever seen from Santillan. And he showed me everything on a world-class level, except for perhaps punching power.
Yep.
So he's going to have to continue to develop as a technician, and his boxing ability and his conditioning's got to be on point. But I do think he has the potential to become a legitimate welterweight contender.
Yeah, main event coming up next, Madueño and Boa Rodriguez. And one of the things about here fighting at Thompson is they match you tough because they have to. They have to figure out what they have with you. A fighter that they're really high on is Sal Sanchez, the Beast, who doesn't speak a lot. He's very quiet. And we saw him lose in this building a couple years ago, built himself back up, and then dug. He had a huge knockout in Sanchez.
Showbox main event. He knocked out the favorite.
O'Quinn.
O'Quinn was supposed to. He was the hot, undefeated prospect. And Sanchez, who's been he's been living up to his nickname, the Beast, recently. He's had a lot of first-round knockouts. Been traveling to Florida and fighting on those Telemundo shows and getting first-round knockouts against guys we haven't heard of. But on Showbox, he fought like a former amateur standout, a guy who's supposed to be maybe the better athlete, maybe the better boxer. Now, Sanchez is somebody who's coming into his own, and somebody we got to look at you know, bantamweight and junior featherweight as, you know, a possible contender.
Yeah, I'm glad. I thought he had maybe plateaued a couple of years ago.
And you know what he hasn't done? He hasn't knocked out Jessica Rosales, who's ready to interview him right now. Let's see how many words we get out of Sal Sanchez. The Beast is standing by with J-Row.
All right, guys. Joining me now, we have Sal Sanchez. And to be honest, we're actually discussing whose nachos those are on the table. We both decided that they're closer to Doug, but they're probably Beto's nachos, and he just kind of scooted them over. But let's get down to it. Sal, you actually just came off of a very impressive win in late September against O'Quinn. We're going to see some of that video in just a bit. But let's talk about that fight, obviously making a huge statement with that first-round knockout.
Yes. I came in as the underdog, so I was motivated and focused, and I was just focused to win. I wasn't focused on a knockout, but, you know, it came early, and I'm glad it did, and I made a big statement.
You know, when you come into a fight as the underdog, how much more does that push you to get that win? Not necessarily in this manner, but to get that win at the end of the night.
I mean, I was just more motivated, like, coming into the fight as an underdog, like, especially the other team, they were talking a lot of stuff before the fight. So, it just motivated me. I stayed focused, and I got the knockout early.
Let's see if we can show those highlights one more time, because, you know, you're standing here and you're able to watch them, obviously getting to see it a different way, getting to relive that moment. Talk us through this and what you're seeing.
Right. He was hurt right there, and I seen that every time he would throw, he would mess with his, he would leave his right hand out. So I switched my jab to a hook, and I caught him right there.
Obviously, that's him going down the second time, and this is...
He was already hurt right there, and then I was just letting my hands go, like, nice. Nothing crazy, like, no wide punches or nothing. But, yeah, he was done right there. I knew I had him right there and stopped him.
And a big, impressive night for you. So I got to ask you, how do you celebrate a huge win like that?
I just took a week off. I went to Vegas you know, celebrated a little bit. Right, the next week I went straight to the gym, yeah, and I'm back to work, and I'll be back in December.
Why do you guys do that? You guys take, you know, one day off, a week off. I've never heard of anybody taking a nice big break after they had that win. Why is it so important for you to stay in the gym and stay active?
This is my job, so, you know, I always got to stay ready because you never know what could pop up. So, yeah.
And you did mention that you will be back fighting in December. That's going to be December 17th right here at the Doubletree. We got confirmation from Alex that we are allowed to say that. But let's talk about being here at the Doubletree. Obviously, our first time back after, you know, the entire quarantine. What's the atmosphere been like here tonight?
It's great. The fans are always good here. And I had a lot of great fights in the Doubletree. And, you know, it's like home. So, yeah, it feels great seeing all the people back in here.
Always a good time out here. And I got to ask, when you watch the fights, do you prefer to watch the fights in person, or do you prefer to watch the fights at home where you can hear the commentary of Doug and Rich and Beto?
Either one is good, but right here, I like seeing all the fans like into it, and like today, all the fans are really they're all into it, so it motivates me more to even fight here again.
That might be the most I've ever heard you talk, to be honest.
Yeah. I'm getting better.
I like it. All right. Well, we'll see in December what kind of an interview we'll get out of you from there. So let's have you sit tight here. But right now, guys, coming up, we do have our main event, Miguel Angel Madueño and Jose Luis Rodriguez. Let's take a look back at yesterday's.
Really happy to be back in California. Every time I fight here, people treat me really well. So I'm extremely happy that I'm back at a main event. What about my opponent? I've seen a couple of videos of him, and I know he's a guy that comes forward and that has pretty good power on his hands. But it doesn't matter to me. It doesn't faze me. I've faced much tougher challenges throughout my career, and I'm ready for a good fight. I had about a 4 to 5 week camp. I've trained very hard with young fellows and good boxer stablemates that I have in Nuevo León, Mexico. I've put in a lot of work for this fight, and I feel very prepared not only to surprise my opponent, but give the fans a great show. This fight goes out to my family and to all those that have always have supported me. I've had a long career. I faced a lot of tough challenges, but I have a lot of people that have been behind me for a long time. And I want to send a special message to my wife, who's been with me throughout this whole time, and she always supports me. I'm going to do my very best tonight.
Estoy contento porque, como usted lo dice, estoy en la pelea principal. Agradeciendo.
Happy to be on this card and be in the main event. I want to thank Mr. Thompson and the promotional company for allowing me this opportunity, and also to my manager Roberto Sandoval. I'm here to show you what I'm made of. My last fight, I got to be honest with you, it was a really difficult fight. I thought I was going to walk in there and get an easy knockout, but Sonny Fredrickson was a very, very tough guy. It took me 10 rounds to be able to, you know, weather them down and get the knockout. It wasn't an easy fight, but what it showed me is that I'm capable of fighting 10 rounds, and better yet, I'm ready for 12. Studying him since he fought Ruben Torres, so I've seen him fight before. Nothing that he does is important or surprises me whatsoever. I think he's just an ordinary opponent for me, considering who I just faced. And obviously he's going to be not as tough as Fredrickson, so I'm here to knock him out. The expectations are getting to be higher in my career, and the only dream I have, like any other fighter, would be to become a world champion in the near future. And I have to do this for Mexico, I have to do this for Wasabe, Sinaloa, I have to do this for my parents, who always believed in me and have supported me since day one when I started in this career of boxing. It's a lot of people that are believing in me, and then there's the new ones that are starting to follow me, and I'm very happy, and I'm gonna do my very best to always show you the best possible fights.
Here we go, fight fans, let's get the action going once again. Please welcome out of the red corner, Jose Luis La Boa Rodriguez.
Jose Rodriguez is a Monterrey, ready to make his ring walk. Y saludos a la gente regia de Monterrey, tierra de los sultanes. Edgar Lara, make sure everybody in Monterrey are sharing it. Love their boxing there in the northern part of Mexico.
He's fought all around, though. He fought in Las Vegas. He's fought in New York at the Garden Theater. Good, solid veteran. 40 yes. fights.
Well-traveled.
And now please welcome in the blue corner, Miguel Angel, El Explosivo Madueño.
Ahí viene Miguel Madueño, Madueño, Coeñe, perdón. A mis enemigos, to my enemies, Valentin Elizalde is what he's coming into. This is a good quinceañera jam right here, Rich. I know you like that. Have you done fights in Mexico, Rich?
Oh, yes, many.
Yeah. I know Doug's done one in a bull ring in Aguascalientes. What about you?
I've been in there as well. That's right. Yeah. And it was a night where everything went wrong on our telecast. Nothing worked. Monitors, microphones, everything.
Shout out Rick Sierra.
Was it outdoors?
It was out. It was
at that Coliseum where they had the bullfights.
Yes. Exactly.
Technical difficulties.
As my friends will say, Mexico.
Yeah.
He's got the beard. He's looking good. Sonny Franco looking fresh though. My goodness, Sonny, where'd that jacket from?
Ladies and gentlemen, Thompson Boxing Promotions is proud to present the feature attraction as this is the main event of the evening. Sanctioned by the California State Athletic Commission, Executive Officer Andy Foster, Chairman John Caravelli. At ringside, your two positions are Kelly Tucker and Jeff Roberts. And should the bout go the distance, your three judges scoring this bout are Fernando Villarreal, Max DeLuca, and Eddie Hernandez. The man in charge of the action at the bell, your referee, Raul Caiz Sr. 8 rounds of boxing action in the lightweight division. And now, ladies and gentlemen, and fight fans joining us around the world on ThompsonBoxing.com, from the Doubletree Hotel in Ontario, California, where champions are made and fighters are born. Ladies and gentlemen, let the battles begin. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner. He stepped to the ring tonight with the black trunks trimmed with white. When he stepped onto the scale, he weighed in officially at 135.9 pounds. As a professional, he has 40 fights to his credit, including 25 victories, 14 defeats with one bout even. 13 of his victories coming to you by way of KO. Ladies and gentlemen, damas y caballeros, de Monterrey, Nuevo León, Mexico, introducing José Luis La Boa Rodriguez. And introducing his opponent, fighting across the ring out of the blue corner. He steps to the ring tonight with the blue trunks with red. When he stepped onto the scale, he weighed officially at 136.6 pounds. As a professional, his record is impressive. Undefeated, 25 wins with 0 losses. 23 of those wins coming to you by way of KO. Ladies and gentlemen, damas y caballeros, de Guasama, Sinaloa, Mexico, introducing Miguel Angel, El Explosivo Madueño. Once again, your referee in charge of the final instructions of Raul Caiz Sr.
All Raul Calle Sr., veteran referee, third man in the ring, Rich Murata with the Tell the Tape.
All right, there's quite a difference in that age, and in this case, because of 40 tough fights that Rodriguez has been through, you'd think that's a real advantage for Madueño. But otherwise, other than the height advantage, there's really not much to choose. But there's a lot to choose between the knockout power between these two.
Yeah, El Mayito in the blue, Madueño. Loboa in black and white. Make sure you share on Facebook or on YouTube. We are watching you guys right now. Saludos a la gente de Sinaloa y también a la gente de Monterrey. Should be a good one. It's our main event tonight here on Thompson Boxing. Our next event will be December 17th. Make sure you download the Thompson Boxing app for all information. Stay up to date. Get gear. Get pictures. Exclusive behind-the-scenes action.
Not sure I've seen that color gloves before.
Yeah, it's on.
It's like an electric blue.
Yeah, we had an electric red earlier. Hey, whatever works, baby. Whatever pops. Look good, feel good, play good, Deion Sanders. Bo is that rugged veteran in the black. He'll stand there and trade with you.
Is boa in Spanish like the snake?
Yeah.
Boa constrictor? Okay.
Por eso le dicen boa, ¿verdad? Por víbora.
Obviously, we're already seeing a difference in the style of Madueño from when he first came here to the United States.
You mean not 1,000 miles an hour?
Exactly.
It was a Tasmanian devil the first time we saw him. Madueño with the punching power. But we also saw him box in his last fight. Wasabi Sinaloa. Any news on Danny Ramon's next fight? We do know that Alex Campanova told us today at lunch that they're working on something for December. Nothing official, though. Danny Ramon, one of the good guys in the sport of boxing.
Yeah, remains right there in the mix at 122 pounds. And I'm sure he's going to be watching with interest the title unification bout between Stephen Fulton and Brandon Figueroa, which is coming up.
Danny Ramon not here tonight because he's driving for a convalescent home.
Bueno really displaying a variety of punches, different punches.
I like the uppercut that he turns into a hook because the uppercut is going to be right there for him with the style and the form that Rodriguez has. Rodriguez does seem to kind of lurch over. And he's got kind of, he'll keep a high guard, but you can get to his chin up the middle.
And let us know where you're watching this fight from. Don't let me know esa pelea. Leave a comment. Let us know where you're checking in from tonight. As he pushes him back, Madueño starting to let his hands go with vicious intentions here in the first round. Moving back, Loboa Rodriguez. Final seconds of the first round. Boa's eating some punches. The veteran standing toe-to-toe with him. And he gets done with one. Like he just turned on another gear, Rich Murata.
It looked like he all of a sudden sensed something that maybe he could get Rodriguez out of there.
I think he sensed that he hurt Rodriguez.
Didn't quite see it, but
I didn't see it either, but he's up close.
Yeah.
I saw something, the eyes roll back, but he tried to seize the moment. And that's the kind of form and energy we're used to seeing from him from the opening bell. But for the first 2.5 minutes of this opening round, he was very measured, and I like what I saw.
There you see Madueño. El Mayo. Como wasabi. Yusuf Alarabi, are you really watching us in Egypt? Come on, man. I got to tell Mr. Thompson where they're watching from, and if I tell him Egypt and you're not there, he's going to call me a liar. Shout out to Yusuf. Second round, scheduled for 8, brought to you by Henry Fortifiber. Hen Vene watching us in Chile. Saludos a toda la gente en Chile. Santiago, Los Paraíso. Un pisco.
Rodriguez looks hardly bothered, though, by that late first-round flurry.
Well, he's been there and done that.
Some of the names, Doug, he's gone up against.
Mario Barrios. And he was competitive with Barrios. Barrios was hitting him
everything but the kitchen sink up top, and then I think Barrios finally got to him by going to the body. But it took Barrios 6 rounds to figure that out.
Yeah, but he goes the distance with everybody else.
Yeah,
like.
Well, I mean, you know, we saw Ace Torres, who can punch, gets very good leverage on his shots. Hit Rodriguez with some choice shots for 8 rounds and couldn't get rid of him.
Gloria Stefan played, so the 305 checked in. Alyssa Agudelo hanging out on Brickell. Nicholas Cavides, my mom's basement, of course. You know, that's a great place to watch boxing.
Ooh,
that's a left uppercut by Madueño. That hurt him.
Yeah, and you could see between rounds, Madueño's corner was asking for that punch.
And they got it.
Yeah, they liked that when he landed the left uppercut, if he turned that same hand into a hook, that he could land both punches.
And there you see Boa turning southpaw briefly, trying to give him a different look. And now he's trying to stay close. He's not giving Madueño any chance of any kind of room to operate.
Yeah, and I think this might be Rodriguez's best chance to inflict some damage on the younger man, is to smother the younger man, even though he's smothering his own punches, just try to maul him on the inside.
Madueño looking at Caiz Sr. like, come on, do something here. He's letting him work out of it.
Yeah, Caiz Sr.'s old school. It's like, work and get out.
Uppercut again for Madueño in the blue. You can hear the punches, the thud. And he moves back Boa.
Wow. I like his left hand. I like that he can double and triple up with his left. You know, left uppercut, left hook to the head, or hook to the body, hook to the head. But he's working his right hand too, and it looks like he's on his way to overwhelming Rodriguez.
Rodriguez going back, and he eats a right hand. Body work from Madueño, you heard that.
Some of those shots are low.
You know, he's actually in the midst of all of this frantic assault. He's pinpointing punches, too.
Yes, he is. He's keeping his head, too, the veteran is.
And the corner of Rodriguez stood up. The commission had to tell them, stay low. You cannot stand up. So they're sensing some desperation in the corner of the fighter in the black.
I think Madueño's inviting Rodriguez to open up so he can counter him right here.
Little possum there towards the end of the round.
And either that or he punched himself out a little bit.
That might be two.
Well, he threw over 700 punches in that last fight against Frederickson.
Wow.
So.
Wow.
Henvene in Chile is saying he doesn't think this fight goes four. And Henvene, you can use the download the Thompson Boxing app on Android or iPhone. Rich Murata figured it out.
That's right.
That means nobody else can complain. Rich, seriously, start a podcast. I want to hear the Rich Murata stories. Okay, forget it.
I'm staring at Beto. You can't see that.
Rich is too busy playing at your local bars in Reno. The concert, which is pretty cool. Make sure you follow Rich on Twitter at Boxing Rich. Dougie Fisher, the editor-in-chief of Ring Magazine, and make sure to subscribe to Ring Magazine and download their app for Ring TV so you can check things out. And you'll get that. And also the Blue Moon Boxing doing good work. Doug has a good podcast.
In the blue corner.
In the blue corner.
Is it you alone, Doug?
No, it's me and Jaime Mota, and sometimes the great Paulie Malignaggi joins us, and that's a lot of fun.
Jaime Mota I worked with on the Corrales-Castillo fight. It was Alan Massengale, myself, and Jaime Mota.
Wow.
We did the international telecast of the Corrales-Castillo one.
Wow. You didn't have to do anything. Just lay out of that one like, okay, they're killing each other, folks. Yeah.
Also, Rich Murata, the president of Nevada Boxing Hall of Fame. By Michelle Castillo. Oh, you hear the body shots again from Madueño. We're a couple feet away from the ring, and you can hear the thud that the punches are landed with those blue gloves. Again. That's a new wrinkle, though, Doug, right? Because when we saw Madueño, he was a headhunter the first couple
times.
He was
a headhunter, and his body was tight, and he was winging his shots. So his punching technique has improved, and he's more poised. I'm not going to say he's a poised fighter, mm-hmm. but he's more poised than he was.
Well, he's trying different things.
Yeah. But his body looks more relaxed, and that's very important for boxers. If you're not relaxed, you're gonna burn out quicker.
Bug Zoom says, I would not be here if it wasn't for Tim Boxale. Appreciate you joining us, Bug Zoom. Make sure you download the Thompson Boxing app and subscribe to the YouTube and the Facebook page for the next fight, which is going to be December 17th. Mark Valencia lets us know that the color of those gloves are iridescent blue.
Iridescent blue.
Primero Boxing has them available.
Oh, cool.
Appreciate you.
There you go. I was going to guess
iridescent.
Ice blue.
Yeah.
Oh, good right hand landed by the boa.
Yeah.
So he's got that in his arsenal, but then he eats one and two.
Oh, this is a crafty veteran.
He's giving these
really that body shot. Him.
It should have.
Yeah. No, it did.
Yeah.
Momentarily stunned Rodriguez. And that was from the right side. He was getting used to the left hooks to the body. Madueño surprised him. Madueño's reminding him, I'm a two-handed fighter.
Madueño from Wasabi, Sinaloa, was mentioned him many times, but I know that Alex Campanoma would love to have him training in Southern California, doing more work here in Southern California.
So he goes back to Sinaloa?
Immediately.
Oh, really?
As soon as he can.
No, you need to stay out here.
Yeah. He's not from the city. He's from the outskirts. So.
He was like from a ranch or a ranch area.
A ranch area. He loved this simple life where it's just rancho and maybe a stoplight, if that. A simple life. And I'm like, why do you fight? He's like, oh, because it's fun. Overhand right. And this is a great move by the veteran Rodriguez, where you're not allowing the heavy puncher to do anything and you smother him.
Right.
And which at times, Rich, can really frustrate a fighter that is looking for the big knockout punch.
Exactly, because he is seeing things now from Rodriguez that he has not seen from other fighters.
True. And he's starting to breathe kind of heavy between rounds.
Yosef Alarabi, appreciate you saying the commentators are flipping good. Yeah, we are. And we being Doug and Rich Murata. And we've said it many times. We know you're watching this. We know you're drinking. It's a Friday night. Look, I got my, I got myself a whiskey ginger right now here in ringside.
And the nachos are mine, by the way.
The nachos are yours. But
they were mine.
We know that you're a hardcore fan watching these fights of guys that you have no idea who they are. Alex Campanoma and Janet Gonzalez and the staff do a great job bringing it to you. So we want to engage with you, the fans. And we're not going to ignore you, because without you, we wouldn't have a broadcast. And it's free, available for you. And we appreciate everything you have with you. And I will say this. For the majority, boxing fans are really intelligent.
Yeah.
You have the small percentage that just love the troll.
Right.
And then Madueño just comes out immediately.
Yeah.
Aggressive. And Boa is holding on.
It's almost like they told him in the corner, go knock him out.
Yeah.
That's your instructions.
Yeah, easier said than done with this guy. Beto, do you know how long of a camp or how much notice Rodriguez had for this matchup?
Rodriguez, as I talked to him, said, I just stay ready. He's like, I'm always in the gym.
Okay.
I know that they're going to call. Like I said, he's had a couple fights with Thompson Boxing. So it's not really much of a camp. He's like, nah, I just go to the gym every day and I work.
It's the life of a journeyman.
Yep.
But he's a high-level journeyman.
Yeah.
He's not a guy who shows up and gets knocked out. And he's not a guy who gives up when he gets hurt, as we're seeing in this fight.
It's hard to hit him flush, isn't it, Rich?
Yeah, he's not getting hit to the head. He was getting hit to the body with some flush shots, but
yeah, he kind of
not
boxes.
To the head.
Yeah, Rodriguez will box out of a crouch. He'll get low. There's some upper body movement there, which is why it would be a smart thing for Madueño to continue to tap the body.
Now, Madueño looks to me here like he's trying to figure him out a little bit.
Yes, he is.
And his last fight for Madueño, when he went against Lubin on a Trillo card in Miami, you're looking at this, and I was telling people, like, dude, this guy can punch. And Tim Boxill is one of the guys I told. And I started watching this fight, and a lot of the commentary was, hey, this guy can actually box.
Yeah.
Like, you could be a puncher, but it's another thing to be a boxer. Thudding punches, overhand right, and Rodriguez shows again. He's got that beard. He can eat a punch.
Yeah, he could take it to the body, too. And most guys can't.
God, he's tough. Aguanta el de Monterrey.
One thing I'll say about Madueño, and he should learn some of these wrinkles from Rodriguez, is Madueño is straight up. He just ate that right hand because he stands straight up. And there's no head or upper body movement. So he's still He's not stiff in his muscles anymore, but he's still kind of stiff in his posture. And that's something that's going to need to change as he advances.
How do you fix that?
You practice it. There's drills that you do in the ring. You know, I'm sure you've seen in the boxing gym where they'll have like string, you know, rope that they will tie to each ring buckle.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? So it's like the rope makes an X, and the fighters move around the ring and duck under the rope.
On the rope, trying to get off of that is Rodriguez. 10 seconds to go in the fourth round. They're trading blows here, and Rodriguez is fighting back. Good round.
Wow.
Good round. That's Rich Murata clapping, and I don't blame you, Rich. That was a good, fun round, and Rodriguez, a lot of heart.
And, you know, Rodriguez had landed a tremendous right hand,
he did.
And then Madueño opened up on him.
Props to Rodriguez surviving that onslaught.
Randall Flagg, good commentary. Madueño is carrying the day, but he's eating a few. We did see him eat a couple in that round.
Now, we have to see how this works on the mind of Madueño a little bit. You know, because he's hitting him shots. He's hitting shots that have felled 23 other guys.
Right.
You know, so, and Rodriguez is still sitting there, moving, crouching, hitting back.
Yeah, and I wonder if, listen, he fought in September. So he's come back in a month. That was a tough fight, a hard 10 rounds. I wonder if he's also starting to feel some things in his body because maybe he didn't have enough time to recuperate after that hard fight.
And he comes out landing a good 1-2. There's Madueño in the blue. El Maito de Wasabi Sinaloa. Bold Rodriguez in black and white. Tough dude. Just a tough dude.
Not a hard fight to score, guys.
No. And Doug's unofficial scorecard.
40-36 after four rounds. It's all been Madueño. But Rodriguez has his spots, like we just saw, with that right hand.
And now it's getting to where Rodriguez is just winging those overhand rights, trying to connect with one. Trying to land a haymaker. Splitting the guard of Madueño.
But Madueño is, I guarantee you, is seeing so many different looks that he's never seen in a ring before. From La Boa.
Yeah, the last fight was an education in many ways, and so is this one.
Ooh, different though.
Yeah, hook lands from Rodriguez. Madueño, right, for my liking, a little bit too stationary right now. And I know some of that is just fighter defiance. It's like letting Rodriguez know, hey, you can't hurt me. But you don't want to make a habit out of that. You never want to pose in front of your opponent. The old timers would always say something needs to be moving. If your hands aren't moving, your feet better be moving. If your hands and your feet aren't moving, you better be moving your head and upper body.
Hey, you see Madueño now in this round. Look at the feet. Great shot right there. His feet are flat. You want him bouncing around. He might be gassed a little bit too. He's been throwing a lot of punches.
Yes, yeah. Madueño has really let his hands go.
Abraham Gonzalez checking in. I used to hear Rich Marano and Mark and Brian. Yeah.
If Madueño is tired and I'm in this corner, I would advise him. Oh, man, those were heavy body shots. That right to the body is something else.
But he eats another right hand.
Yeah.
And he's going to the body, digging the body.
Oh, my
Rodriguez on the ropes, and he goes down.
Chopping down a tree. Wow.
It was a matter of time. He dug to the body, finally went down here in the fifth.
Oh, I can't believe.
That was like three or four rights to the body there. Then he had all his leverage and power.
Literally like he was chopping down a tree. And this tree got up.
And on the rope, Madueño trying to finish it here in the fifth. Rodriguez is tough. He's trying to cover up.
Ooh,
he hasn't recovered. Eats a left. Overhand right from Rodriguez. He's still fighting back. Digging his Madueño. And that's it. Raul Caiz jumps in, protects the fighter. A stoppage from Madueño here in the fifth. And I'm okay with it because it was only a matter of time. Protect the fighter.
It was the right thing to do, in part because Madueño had kind of figured him out. He knew that whenever he would get Rodriguez's back to the ropes, Rodriguez bends at the waist. And so he would just throw body shots. And even if he missed to the body, he would sometimes put the head while Rodriguez was bent over forward. So in a way, Rodriguez was kind of a sitting duck anytime he went to the ropes.
Let me tell you something. People in his division are going to have to deal with this guy, and it's not going to be easy because he has tremendous power and a variety of punches.
Yeah. Now he's both hands are powerful. Look at that. Those are the right hands. Yeah.
Those right hands to the body were doing the trick.
And that was a beautiful two-punch combination that got him up against the ropes, right to the body, right cross to the head, and then he focused on the body with the right hands.
You know, really,
and it should have been over right here, but Rodriguez is insanely tough.
Yeah. Almost nobody has stopped this guy. I mean, this guy goes the distance, and he wins a lot of those distance.
Right, remember I told you with Mario Barrios, Barrios couldn't hurt him. He had to go to the body to get that stoppage in the seventh round.
And Rodriguez
here, Madueño does it in five rounds.
Rodriguez was showing him every kind of look possible and every kind of strategy and smothering and crouching and hitting him those wild overhand rights and doing different things against him. And finally, Madueño was able to deal with him.
He figured out the puzzle, and there's still things for him to work on. I do think he needs to work on his head movement. I do think he needs to practice the jab a little bit more. But there's something there.
Yeah,
there's
exactly.
A lot to work with. And then factor in, he's only 22 years old.
That's another thing.
And this is his 26th fight? 26-0? Good grief.
This is still a raw talent.
Yes.
I mean, he's had a lot of fights. What is tonight's number? 26.
Yeah, 26.
Yeah, but he's still a raw talent, and he still needs polishing. But as I mentioned, he's got to get his situation figured out with his trainer.
Who can't
come up here yet to be with him.
Yeah.
But once that's done and they start polishing this gem.
Sonny Franco, let's go.
Ladies and gentlemen, the end comes. 2 minutes, 46 seconds of round number five. Referee Raul Kais Sr. puts a stop to this contest, declaring your winner by way of a knockout and still undefeated from Guasave, Sinaloa, Mexico, Miguel Angel Explosivo Madueño.
Yeah, good fight. Madueño stays undefeated, and don't go anywhere. You're going to hear an interview. La entrevista ahorita va a seguir con Madueño. Clover Games, Henevene, Bug Zoom. Appreciate everybody who's watching us tonight for the first time. Thank you for showing us some love tonight on Facebook and on YouTube. And as always, look, the sportsmanship too. Boa Rodriguez, pro all the way around, takes the picture, took the pounding that takes the picture, and it's a gentleman's sport at the end of the day, and that's a lot of respect between the two. And there you go. You see him messing around like, I'm hit him on the chin right here.
Wow.
Yeah. Monterrey and Sinaloa, two tough Mexicans going at it. There will be an interview with them. Doug, you see this. You do the rankings for Ring Magazine. Madueño, as Rich said, very raw still, but there's something there, isn't it?
There is. If he can get down to 135 pounds, he's going to be bigger than most lightweights. I mean, he has world-class power for a junior welterweight. So if he can make 135, and he probably can because he's 22, he's going to be a force to be reckoned with. And the last two fights are going to serve him very well as he advances and they step up the level of his opposition. And right now, I would say he's probably knocking on the door at a top 10 ranking at lightweight.
Really?
Maybe 140 pounds. Beating Sonny Fredrickson, Fredrickson's that guy who's like a spoiler, maybe like a gatekeeper. So you beat a gatekeeper, it means that you're for real, but he didn't like crash the gates. He had to bang on those gates for a long time, and then he got through in the final round. And tonight, we saw him go some rounds with a wily veteran, a journeyman, a guy he's supposed to be, but a guy we're not used to seeing being stopped. And he figured things out. He made the adjustments. He figured out the body, when the left to the body wasn't getting through, he switched to the right hands to the body and noticed maybe a round or two before the fifth round, ooh, I stiffened him with that right to the body. I'm going to keep doing it. So he's not just a dumb pug. He's not just a slugger in there. There is the potential to develop into a legitimate boxer puncher.
Yeah, vivi mi vida, Mark Anthony. J-Ro is standing by with El Muchacho de Guasave, Sinaloa.
All right, guys, joining us now, we have Miguel Angel Madueño. Pues, Miguel, ahora te quedas invicto y tienes otro knockout en tu record. Háblame un poco de esta noche y cómo te fue para usted.
Pues me sentí muy bien, alegre más que nada, porque por primera vez me da el espacio el señor Thompson y el señor Alex de encabezar una función. Estoy muy agradecido por eso y muy contento.
Terminaste esta noche en el quinto asalto, lo tumbaste y pues pararon la pelea después de eso. ¿Pensabas que iba a terminar un poco más temprano que el quinto?
Realmente sí, pensaba que iba a terminar temprano. Para serle sincero, yo daba 3 rounds en esta pelea, se me extendió un poquito más. Es un peleador en el que aguanta bastante, porque le pegué golpes fuertes de poder, sin embargo nunca se dio hacia atrás. Tiene mi respeto ese rival, pero gracias a ese knockout, y es lo que nos interesa.
Ahora estamos impuestos a mirar un knockout cuando tú estás entrando en el ring. ¿Estás tratando por el knockout o solamente te está pasando?
Realmente no nos vamos a ir muy lejos, vamos a hablar de esta pelea. Yo intentaba el knockout rápido, no se me estaba dando, entonces dije vamos a darle la pausa. Si el knockout viene solo, bienvenido sea, y si no, vamos a tratar de hacer un buen trabajo, pues gracias a Dios se nos dio, pero en cada pelea nos esforzamos para sumar un knockout más.
Pues ahora, ¿qué sigue para usted y tu equipo?
Como se lo digo siempre y anteriormente, eso se lo dejo a mi manejador, que es Roberto Sandoval de Tijuana. Muchas gracias al señor Alex y al señor Thompson, que es el jefe de aquí de los Juegos de Oro. Gracias a ellos.
Para todos que están en casa hoy, ¿qué les quieres decir a tu familia, tus amigos, tus fans, todos que están mirando esta noche?
No, pues como siempre, agradecer a todos, a mi familia, a mi nana, a todos que han de estar allá en mi casa, en el rancho, mirándome. Gracias por todo, a mis entrenadores que también me están mirando, a Gapito Díaz, Mario Rodríguez, a mi tío Miguel, es preparador físico mío y es parte de mi familia. Le agradezco todo el sacrificio que hace con nosotros. Y aquí, que tuve mucha porra, ahí está un parte de mi rancho. Y muchas gracias por eso, le agradezco a todos ellos por estar presente aquí. Gracias.
Miguel Angel Madueño, felicidades, que se queda invicto esta noche con la victoria. Guys, we'll send it back to you.
All right, let me give you the Cliff Notes version of that. He said that he's always looking for the quick knockout, but it didn't happen today. That he's looking forward to coming out here, but he had a tough rival that it was hard to actually knock him out, but he was happy that he got it. And it's always a lesson learned from every single fight. As far as what the future is going to be, he said, I leave that up to my manager. And also want to say thanks to Mr. Thompson and also his entire team. And shout out to everybody back home watching him in Wasabi, Sinaloa. So it's interesting to hear him say, yeah, I was looking for that quick knockout. I want that. But it didn't happen today, but he did have... He learned something from himself.
Well, it's good that he knows he can't always whack guys out in 1 or 2 rounds. For starters, it gave us a show.
Yeah.
We had a main event. It went, 5 rounds. Rodriguez had his moments. And it's a real thrill for us to watch fighters like Madueño or even in the previous bout, Akitsugi, mature. Like the first time we see them, they may be one-dimensional. But the more experience they get, the more rounds they go, and the tougher the opposition gets, the better they get. And we see that evolution, and it's really satisfying.
4 good fights coming your way tonight. And as we talked about at the beginning of the show, Rich, club shows is where you make your bones, and it's you got to fight your way out of here. And we have some good ones tonight.
Well, and yeah, and what did we talk about? That these are the kind of shows where careers are developed, where champions are developed. That kid in there that we just saw, Madueño, I'm telling you, I'm excited by this guy, and I think there's something really there, and I can't wait to see him again, and I can't wait to see the further development, which I expect. And if he just keeps his head right and attends to his lessons, he's going to be something to watch here in the next couple of years.
And that's not hyperbole from Rich Marotta. When he says he's excited, he really is excited. And this is a man who's seen Bruce Springsteen over 50 times, so he's ready to go. So it was a good night of boxing, and make sure you download the Thompson Boxing app for more behind-the-scenes footage, pictures, and stuff from training camp. Our next show is going to be December 17th right here in Ontario. Stay tuned for information about tickets. So for everybody involved on the broadcast, for Joe Pahar, Polifornia, the entire camera crew, it takes a small staff to make it look like a big-time production. Shout out to the audio, the camera people, everybody behind the scenes, everybody putting up the ring. For Jeanette Gonzalez, Alex Campanovo, and Mr. Ken Thompson, I'm Bethel Duran saying good night. For my partners, Rich Marotta and Doug Fisher, we will see you December 17th. Good night from Ontario, California. You've been watching Thompson Boxing.